gentlemen, it is Tuesday, May 3rd, 2016. I'm Alex Jones. This is going to be another incredibly important transmission. Stay with us. But first, the globalist puppet Obama rubs the American people's faces in the tyranny.
According to a Pew Research poll, mainstream media has a 6% approval rating. Think about that. The globalist megabanks controlling the perception of the American masses for their own gain isn't a passive event. What lurks behind that dismal approval rating is a roaring distrust that will eventually morph into a hammer of truth, shattering all of the propaganda clamoring for the attention of 320 million people. That bubble of overpaid sophist minions churning out their American version of Pravda sat comfortably at the White House correspondents' dinner over the weekend, chuckling with sycophantic glee in the presence of the most non-transparent president in the history of the United States of America.
8 years ago, I was a young man, full of idealism and vigor. And look at me now. I am gray, grizzled, just counting down the days till my death panel. At home and abroad, journalists, like all of you, engage in the dogged pursuit of informing citizens and holding leaders accountable and making our government of the people possible. And it's an enormous responsibility. And I realize it's an enormous challenge at a time when the economics of the business sometimes incentivize speed over depth, and when controversy and conflict are what most immediately attract readers and viewers. The good news is there's so many of you that are pushing against those trends. And in such a climate, it's not enough just to give people a megaphone. And that's why your power and your responsibility to dig and to question and to counter distortions and untruths is more important than ever. Taking a stand on behalf of what is true does not require you shedding your objectivity. In fact, it is the essence of good journalism.
But for a brief moment, comedian Larry Wilmore brought some clarity to the dulled senses of the media whores sipping their champagne.
MSNBC got rid of so many black people, I thought Boko Haram was running that network. What's going on? See, some of America's finest black journalists are here tonight. Don Lemon's here, too. Hey, Don, how's it going? Alleged journalist Don Lemon, everybody. But I have to say, it's great. It looks like you're really enjoying your last year of the presidency. Saw you hanging out with NBA players like Steph Curry, Golden State Warriors. That was cool, yeah. You know, it kind of makes sense, too, because both of you like raining down bombs on people from long distances, right? Yeah, sure. What? Am I wrong? What? Speaking of drones, how is Wolf Blitzer still on television? Ask a follow-up question. Hey, Wolf, I'm ready to project tonight's winner. Anyone that isn't watching the Situation Room? Who are you killing tonight? Can't be print journalism. That industry's been dead for a while now, right? Sorry. CNN is here tonight. You mentioned CNN? Yep.
Look at those traitors. This guy knows they're dead.
A long time. Yep. Used to watch it back when it was the news network.
He's not even taking a risk going after him. He knows it. That guy's smart. I'll get him on.
I'll see you in here tonight.
Since the Smith-Mundt Act was quietly overturned in 2013, legalizing propaganda to be fed to the American people, I humbly call out of pure reason that the Pulitzer, the Emmys, the Peabody, the Edward R. Murrow, and all the other prizes awarded to journalists since 2013 be returned. And all of these awards to be put on hold until American journalism is returned to its proper status as stated in the First Amendment.
In medical news tonight, a chip the size of a grain of rice could save your life.
Mm-hmm. I'm not going to wait around and watch my family die around me.
John Bound for Infowars.com.
Choose wisely, my friends. Tuesday, May 3rd, 2016. We're going into world government. The globalists are collapsing industries, cities, states, regions, countries, and building armored compound fortresses, returning to the Dark Age model. The social contract has been broken by design to bring in a long de-evolution of civilization for the general human world. Classical tyranny is now being integrated with high-tech control. Only a mass awakening, a transcendence, and a discovery of the enemy plan, and an admission of the enemy plan attacking us at point-blank range. Only an awakening to the giant monster in the room will allow us to overthrow this system. We have a very good chance at defeating it because it's based on destroying prosperity, destroying honor, destroying competition, destroying free will and free association. It is anathema to the general human will. But the globalist combines wickedly wish for total control over the species and the future. And they intend to get full control. They're not there yet. And in their attempts to get there, they are pushing us towards global conflict, economic collapse, and societal degeneration. They are setting up frauds. They are setting up systems that consolidate and destroy all prosperity outside of their controlled systems. As a plan, this is not mismanagement. This is a scientifically directed Agenda 21 post-industrial program. Now, when I say post-industrial, that's for you and I. We'll still have our little smartphones and baubles that surveil us and track us like sentinel sentries in the prison panopticon. But the real civilization and the real freedom of travel and the real freedom of raising your children and having your own ideas is being swept away. The good news is there are massive awakenings taking place. Here's what's coming up today. Lord Monckton, the champion of trying to get the UK out of the EU and one of the founders of UKIP, taking Europe and the UK by storm, populist, patriot, Libertarian Party, will be joining us to discuss the move to bring England, Ireland, Scotland, Northern Ireland, out of the globalist system that will then obviously cause a chain reaction. This is a massive event and heralds the New World Order Project is in deep trouble. They'll try to reconstitute it in other ways, but this is a devastating setback for the enemy. When I say enemy, I mean your, mine, my family's mortal sworn agents of death. That's the globalist. The ones that have the abortuaries and sell the baby parts and grow humanoids and cows for harvesting. Those people. As cold-blooded and psychopathic as Satan's third eye. Now, we're going to get into that. We're going to get into the Trump campaign and all the things that are happening, and Trump surging nationally in polls to a gigantic lead nationally, surging past Hillary. We're going to be getting to all of that. He now has a 34-point jumbo lead in California over Cruz, and it's accelerating daily. The neocon crime syndicate has gone into conniption fit overdrive, activating Glenn Beck and Ted Cruz to say everyone must fast. Basically, this is a choice between good and evil, close quote. Cruz is like Christ. Trump is like the devil. And trying to invoke Christianity and just ghost dance, end of days type cultism to try to manipulate Christians that they need to do this. This is totally cold-blooded, absolutely synthetic, coming from these two sociopaths in my educated, informed analysis. That's all up on drudgereport.com. We've got a lot of news, obviously, up on Infowars.com. We're also going to get to some other key health news. Now, this has been known for over 100 years. In fact, the Romans, if somebody was sick, they would say, get them up on the roof, get them in a loincloth, have them sit out in the sun for 4 or 5 hours if they didn't have any sun. Go out and get fresh air. Doctors always say that. You know, you watch Mayberry, shows, the Andy Griffith Show, and somebody's sick. The doctor says, "Why, you need some fresh air and sunshine, and you need some milk." Everybody already knows this, but here it is, Daily Mail, big study, how sunshine cuts blood pressure and makes you thinner. New research reveals benefits that aren't linked to vitamin D. Vitamin D is part of it. Your body produces vitamin D with it, the type it can absorb. But the bigger issue is the nitrous oxide in the blood. Look, personally, I can be a little bit down, exhausted, go out and get an hour of serious sun. I just feel rejuvenated. We're just like plants. We don't have photosynthesis, but we basically have something very, very similar that goes on in our skin. And yes, you will die from too much sun. You will die quicker without it. That's why Cass Sunstein, the White House regulations are, remember, once being in the sun banned. He wants, by law, 50% sunscreen and arresting people that say it's good, like he wants global warming deniers arrested. Just go read his papers. Because that creature knows that you are absolutely dependent on the sun, like everything else on this planet. But, of course, the UN likes to play like they're God. And so that's why they voted 5 years ago to say the sun doesn't affect climate or anything else. That is the most asinine statement the planet has ever seen. But I'm digressing. We've got exclusive reports here from Breitbart. A chart, deportation budget shows 25% increase in the budget while deportations plummet. Yes, that's how you do it. That's giving services and all these rights to anybody that can get here to incentivize more to come here. We're going to be breaking all of that down as well today. Colorado sends non-vaccinated parents illegal order to register their children with the state in preparation for forced inoculation. That's up on Infowars.com. That dovetails with Infowars.com, Paul Joseph Watson article. Judge orders mother's child to be sentenced because she, quote, believes in chemtrails. The judge actually said that. Well, so does Merle Haggard, Prince, Chuck Norris, and thousands of scientists that can read the declassified government documents that geoengineering is going on and is toxifying the planet. Even the Council on Foreign Relations admits they're doing it, but says it's for a greater good. But she believes in it, and the judge says that doesn't exist. So my children. Talk about cult control. That's what we're dealing with here. Now, before I go any further and get into what's happening in the economy and the election, the demonization of Donald Trump has now gone into total and complete absolute hyperdrive. And there's obviously a popular television program called Quantico that airs on one of the big national networks where we see all the wonderful heroes at the FBI saving us. Now, I want to be clear. I don't think all the FBI agents out there are evil people, but the system is evil, is corrupt. Look what Hillary Clinton's gotten away with. But an American militia cell, now in the latest episode, the GOP presidential hopeful campaign slogan, Make America Great Again, is yelled before an attack in Chicago. ABC's Quantico. American terror cell shouts, Make America Great Again before attack. And the ADL has come out and said that it's Nazi to say that. I knew this, but I looked it up this weekend. Dozens and dozens of countries from South Africa currently to places in Europe to China, they say, you know, make our country great, make it great again. Obviously, you can go find some white supremacist who said sometime in history, make America great again or make America great. This is crazy. It's like saying Alexander the Great's name was Alexander the Great, so he's a Nazi. No, saying make a country, make a leader, make a culture, make a team great again. I've seen the slogan, make UT great again. So this is an attack on language, and it's so fundamental and it's so over the top where they just do this propaganda placement, this brainwashing, and it's everywhere. And they do it to yours truly all the time, where they'll even put me in mainstream fiction shows, a talk show host named Alex Jones that's a murderer or a bank robber or a child molester, and people go, oh, I saw that show where you're a child kidnapper. And this is how they operate. And they do it on the news, Bill O'Reilly, and sexual predators online are a major problem. They cut to me yelling about the police state. Nothing to do with that. I have no criminal record. They just do it because they think you're dumb. Well, they're doing it to Donald Trump big time, and it shows a new level of it. Let's go ahead. For TV viewers, you can see it. The video's up on Infowars.com. But let's go ahead and go to this little trailer for ABC.
What possible reason would I have for wanting to hurt innocent people? Why would I want to destroy my own career?
I don't know. Maybe Afghanistan broke you. Maybe you realized what a worthless war it was when you got back. And you got to talking to one of those cell members one day and realized you were fighting on the wrong side.
Side or something. If you ever say something like that to me again, you're going to have a whole new set of problems. Yeah. I love this country.
Isn't that what they said when they attacked it? Make America great again?
Agent Kent.
Better back.
So, see, the terrorist attack earlier, and that's in the plot they report here, and then again they're repeating it, make America great again. Those terrorists that didn't strike, those patriots that said China and the communist Chinese were screwing us over, well, now they're terror attacking. And then don't you worry. They've got it in the hopper to provocateur, actually stage it themselves. Maybe like Eric Holder and his little buddies did at the Justice Department and the ATF. We even know the names of the FBI agents, the CIA people. It was in the national news what the witnesses saw. They were there planting the big gray sticks of butter, and they told the federal workers, never mind, we're doing some phone work. They said, we never saw phone workers look like this before, and they identified them. We even found their hotel receipts, the head of the FBI hostage rescue team, when he denied he was there. Oh, you were there. You even signed your own name at the hotel, didn't you, buddy? You ought to be proud of yourself. All right, let's go ahead and turn off that beautiful voice, and let's go to this next clip. This is Glenn Beck, who attacked me, lied about me over the years, just did incredible misrepresentations that I just ignored and said, I'm turning the other cheek because it's a diversion. I'm not doing it. He needs to change. He needs to stop. He needs to, you know, quit what he's doing. He's on a power trip. And I did that. But now he's running around saying and having children on stage crying with him and saying it's his priesthood. And the holy man is Ted Cruz, who is running around all over national TV on all the globalist programs, going along with the ABC News program and the ABC TV that Make America Great Again or terrorists. They're going to blow stuff up. ABC's Quantico, American Terrorist Cell, shouts, Make America Great Again before attack. And he's all over the TV. We played this yesterday. We can play it. It's more today going, we're not a divisive nation. It kind of talks like George W. Bush, Herbert Walker. And I tell you, it's wrong, the hate that this man is spewing. It's wrong. I'm an immigrant myself. I thought you were American citizen and you could run for office. I mean, it's just all pandering and deception. Total pandering. And now he's plunging in the polls. There's an article up on Infowars.com that just went up and video of it, the tiny crowds he's getting. Just like Hillary would have crowds of 500 people and Sanders would have crowds of 50,000. He was winning all the first primaries, so they just openly stole them. So her people went, okay, we'll go ahead and go with the winners. So they went with Hillary. Such a cult, they are. But now, with Ted Cruz, the fact that he's come out and endorsed the Black Lives Matter, the social justice warriors, the Mecha, La Raza, just unintentional comedy troops, waving Mexican flags everywhere, hopping around, screaming, and then attacking people, saying, we're not violent. I shouldn't laugh, it's unbelievably stupid, but it is ridiculous. It makes me very sad, but it's also funny at the same time. It's bittersweet. All this circus is going on, and he comes out and attacks that. Trump's going way up in the polls. In California, everywhere else, 56% nationally in scientific polls, turbocharging, 34% ahead in California of Cruz. It's crazy. And Glenn Beck is running around with the little hokey outfits he wears on purpose. I've noticed sociopaths and psychopaths always try to act wimpy and non-threatening. Because behind the scenes, they're just vicious demons. I know a lot of folks know Glenn Beck. They say he is a terror. I don't mean he throws a fit or gets angry sometimes. I mean, he is just a power-tripping, thinks he's God, literally runs around just foaming at the mouth. If his food isn't absolutely perfect, he just goes into conniption fits. He's an arrogant sack of filth, okay? And he's not Christ-like. But he sits there with this little wimpy, with little ascots and little sweaters. Oh, hi, I'm not threatening, I'm nice. When we come back, I'm going to play some of these clips where he's invoking God and saying, you better vote for Ted Cruz or you're going to go to hell, basically. And let me tell you something. Or America's going to hell is what he's saying. How many cults have we seen where they say the end of the world's next month, and all these people sell their houses, give them to the preacher, and the preacher runs off with $100 million. That's what gives Christianity a bad name, is cult leaders like Glenn Beck. The guy just savors being a cult leader. By the way, it's destroying his media operation. It's imploding around him, but he can't help it. He's got to dance around and say he's a prophet. It's disgusting. We'll be back. The last few months, I've told you this, but intensifying. Evil's being let out of the pit right now. I can feel it rising. And I can also feel good rising, the spirit of God coming back into the world as well. We are in very dangerous waters. And people like Donald Trump are only one manifestation of what's going on. He's obviously a guy, an alpha male that likes prosperity, loves this country. I think he's got a lot of worldly issues and problems, don't we all? The people that got a lot of good also have a lot of bad. Our enemies are the people that don't have hardly any good but have a bunch of bad. And I don't enjoy getting up here and attacking people like Glenn Beck. Let's get that straight. But when I see manifest smoking evil, the guy's on fire with sniveling evil. So at a spiritual level, I can see him, and I can see all of his fruits, and it's just a prancing demon, a Nelly feminine con artist preying on people, and it makes me want to throw up. And I'll just be honest with you. And I love Christ, and I have a relationship with God, and I know that there's a spiritual battle going on. And I know my best work's like dirty rags, and I do have the Holy Spirit. I feel God constantly. It's very humbling. And as the evil intensifies, I get more discernment, more focus, more intelligence that God gives me. That's what the Bible says it'll do. And I am constantly almost in tears because I can feel the presence of God. And I know how worldly I am, and it's like being naked and ashamed. And I see all these proud, evil men, they will fall. They will be broken. And I'm not sure what's coming in the future, but everybody feels it. Everybody sees it. All I can tell you is everybody better get right with God. And all these people out there that think this is funny, you're not going to think it's funny very soon. We have been insulated in this country because of our ancestors who weren't perfect, but they were the best there were from every corner of the world. We were the new world. But we were the most inventive, and the most freedom ever allowed did happen here for a short time. So great wealth and blessing was brought to us because of the free thinkers that set up this country. And now we've been turned into an engine of abomination. And all I ask is God to spare my children. And I mean, we live in a country where they kill babies and sell their body parts, and where they do put chemicals in the water to brain damage you and your family and cause infertility. That's just the start. Do you understand? We live in a country with thousands of aircraft flying around spraying poison on us, and mothers that talk about it get arrested and have their kids taken in Colorado. It's going to get a lot worse, folks. They're coming for everybody. Do you understand that? And what's sad is they want to force you to submit to their evil because they want your soul. They want your will. They want you to willingly turn yourself over to it. And that's how a coward dies, 1,000 deaths, is they convince themselves that the evil is good and lie to themselves and accept the evil as if it's not bad because they're so scared of the truth deep down. They decide to have a great delusion. They decide to become mentally ill. And they decide to believe that the evil is good and that the good is evil. I mean, Glenn Beck famously let them put chemicals in his eyes. What was it, for an Esquire cover story? Was it Esquire, or was it? Yeah, it was Esquire. You can look it up. Just type Glenn Beck crying. And he joked about it on video, knowing it would go out that he was fake, to let the system know, I'm fake, I'm a fraud. I'll let the liberals know I'm a fraud and make fun of conservatives and patriots and Christians, but my own audience wants to believe in me so they won't see it. Signaling that I'm a traitor, I'm a piece of filth, promote me, I'll lead these people down a rat hole. And he was so dishonorable and so rat-like, even News Corp threw him out, not wanting to be around something like that. Because even though News Corp's corrupt, there's a lot of problems, still powerful men still want to be around honor. Even though they hate it, they sold out, they're guilty, and they hate it. Believe me, I know them. But this little son of a bitch loves it, excuse me, God. He loves betraying people. He gets off on it. He's committed to Satan. Oh, I hate that guy right there. Yeah, he says I'm scary. You bet I'm scary, buddy. Because I'm only one billionth of what you're going to face at the white throne judgment. The dishonor of these people is so manifest. I just want to get away from them. I can't look at them anymore. It's how they enjoy lying to people. They enjoy dishonor. I just, even tuning into their spirit, even picking up on how they are, empathizing, you know, it's horrible. It's horrible. These are predators against their own species. And I don't hate them. It's a feeling in the last few years I never had before. It's beyond that. I want to be apart from them. I want to be in another dimension for them. I want them to go be with their own kind. They call that place hell. And to be there forever. Away from me and my family and other kindred spirits that want to be with God. It's that simple. It's a choice these people make. They make their own hell. They make, and I don't want to get religious here, folks, or spiritual, but the point is, I sit there and I look at these abominations, these demonic creatures. You almost see a tail and horns on that guy. I mean, he is so freaking evil. I mean, I have to control myself constantly not to cry on air. I never each cry maybe once every 2 or 3 years on air when I talk about family or some story. I saw some story about basset hounds with this baby that's brain dead. But I had to realize, I said, I can't cover that story on air before I went on air because I'll start crying. Because of the humanity that's gone from us, but these dogs have this love, this commitment. It's everything in the universe. And these sociopaths and psychopaths think a dog loving a brain dead child that it loved when it wasn't brain dead from a stroke. They think it's weakness in the dog. No, you're the weak people, you sociopaths and psychopaths. You're the people that never scale the heights of love and honor, that never have the dreams. You don't care about other people, you fools. And you prance around and claim that you care about other people. When you hate them and want to dominate them and see them hurt because it makes you feel bigger. I don't need to pray against Glenn Beck or even cursing. You cursed yourself. And I know you must have had a horrible childhood. You claim you did, but it's all lies and suicide parents, all this darkness, but probably real. You're a creation of this planet. And you're just more pathetic, scared wreckage. And in your own delusion, you really think when you're in that fantasy land that you are a soldier of Christ. Your delusion is so great. But that's only a garment you put on. In your heart, you know who you are when the lights go off. And I see you, Glenn Beck and Ted Cruz. And I'm ashamed that my gut told me Ted Cruz was an evil robot, but I still just hoped and dreamed and was lied to. But I'm done ranting about you. I want to go to this clip, and then I'll get to the other news. Let's go ahead. Your TV viewer, for radio listeners, the clip's up on Infowars.com. I'll play it now. Let's go from Right Wing Watch, the establishment that got this to make fun of Christians and discredit us, White House run, putting this out, again, with their own operative to discredit the Liberty Movement. Here he is.
Usually by the time it's the Texas, we're like, whatever. Every single state is
being required, and I believe, and they're going to rake me over the coals for saying it, so be it. I believe that's the Almighty God saying, each one of you, I want you to stand and you choose good or evil. Which way will you go? Am I your God, and are you still my people? Choose who you serve. Before I walked out on stage, Ted and I got down on our knees. knees and we prayed. And we didn't pray. We didn't pray for us. We prayed for the nation and for you. He is a servant at heart. He is a man who was raised for these times. People don't believe that stuff anymore, but I do. If God raised George Washington and Ben Franklin and Thomas Jefferson and Thomas Paine, if he put that collection
Donald
together...
Donald Trump is a servant raised up by the devil. I know a servant when I see one. And at first, our computer was playing it fast. That wasn't on purpose. We weren't trying to make it sound like a chipmunk for 10 seconds. I don't mean to get emotional watching that. It's just that I think the jury's partially out on Donald Trump. My gut tells me he's for real, but he can be manipulated. But the reason they hate him is they know he's his own person, a nationalist that doesn't like us having bad deals, and that he thinks he can save America for his big ego and his own family. Well, you know, that's natural and normal. But Glenn Beck, I know Glenn Beck far too well. And when you've got ABC TV saying Make America Great Again is what militias do when they blow up schools, just made up, and you've got the whole media and all these criminal groups and all these Ford Foundation groups targeting Donald Trump and myself and everybody else and trying to sell this big lie that we're racist and we're horrible because we've got to have some border and some fair trade deals. It's crazy. It's an attempt to defeat logic and to bring in an age of total insanity. And, you know, I've got Ted Cruz clips here saying he's hoping on a miracle. He seeks divine intervention in Indiana. Forget Donald Trump. It's the battle of nationalism versus these globalists. And look at the company Glenn Beck keeps, Priebus and the Republican leadership and the Democrats and George Will in the Washington Post saying, we decide we are sovereign. You don't, your vote doesn't count as an individual. We need to suspend it and give it to Hillary. I mean, that's what he said. I read the quote like seven times yesterday. In fact, will somebody run that in if you haven't? Hey, listen, there was never any voting. We're sovereign. We run the country. We're the party. Sit down and shut up. Here's Glenn Beck. He says that, you know, it's good against evil, and the devil's raised up a serpent over here. We know the devil's raised up Hillary Clinton, who you're saying we should go for, Glenn Beck, over Donald Trump. Give me a break. We know she's a bona fide witch, literal devil worshiper. And you sit there and you point your finger at Donald Trump and say he's the devil? I'm going to stop. I got to get off him. Let's just get off. He's too evil. I can't. In fact, I don't even look at him because he's so evil. Just get him. I can't look at him. It's like Obama. God help me. And notice he's on a suicide mission against liberty. Doesn't matter if he loses 60% of his audience and everything and the stations he's on start going bankrupt and everything else. He doesn't care. He's got to stop Donald Trump. He's got to stop the nationalists. He's got to stop the patriots. They've had the Pentagon and the State Department come back out again and say that there were no. Obama never said that there wouldn't be boots on the ground in Syria. He only said it 16 times on video. And then now they've come out and said that there's no Al-Qaeda, you know, in Al-Nusra or ISIS. And now they go, no, actually it is there and it's better it's there because we like them. You can't fool an honest man. You can't con an honest man. That's one of the best sayings ever. My late uncle always said that, Buckley's dad. Because our brains just don't work like yours. All this mentally ill con artist bull just sticks right out. You people are a joke. You think it's smart? You can lie and twist? That's not smart. That's dumb. You're lying to yourselves. I'm going to stop. I'm going to go to a bunch of clips when we come back from break. Briefly, we fund this operation, and we're under attack, and everybody knows that. Demonization and black ops and dirty tricks, and I love it because I know it means we're over the target, but it's good to be able to provision ourselves in this fight and to have a seawall against the enemy. We really don't really have that seawall, but we're doing okay. We've been able to have the people we have. I'd like to hire some more folks. We're trying that right now and just hoping the funding comes through. We have the best products, the best water filters, whatever the best stuff is, the best. I go out, make a good deal and get it. The best selection of non-GMO, heirloom seeds, you name it. All survival items are 10% off through the week. And I'm just extending this and twisting arms. I don't know how long I can do it, but 30 to 40% off on the My Patriot Supply foods, the entire family of their foods, freshest, newest foods, private labeled as InfoWars Select at InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsSelect.com, and it's all there. 30 to 40% off the already really low prices that My Patriot has. Good, clean, wholesome, high-quality food that I've chosen for my family. Great shelf life, the best containers, the best packaging. Everything from 72-hour bug-out kits to 1 year and 2 year supplies. And I'm storing up a lot more at our office and medical supplies and everything else. The government's doing it. They call us kooks when we do it and weirdos. Whatever, that didn't work anymore. Media's got 6% trust rate. Congress has got a 9% approval rating. Go ahead and say I'm evil all day. That's my certification as a good guy. But I hope we never need to use this. But I think people that have the means especially should try to provision for people around you and what's happening, because everything the globalists do is about making us dependent on them. Everything they do is about making us not able to support ourselves. And just the last 6 months, my gut told me, I saw the signs, and again, if there's tornadoes in town and I go get in the basement, and it doesn't hit my house, I'm not a kook. It's great I got in the basement, and unfortunately it tears up houses 5 miles away. But if tornadoes are coming my way, I get in the basement, or I get in the bathroom if I don't have a basement, and houses that don't have a basement. I grew up in Dallas seeing tornadoes every year. We lived on a hill over a lake, and I'd see them 10 miles away, gray, you know, over the farmland, and then hitting the city and turning, you know, the color of houses white gray, and then going out in the lake and turning blue, you know, water spouts. My dad say, "Hey, they could form here. Let's go get in the basement." That place had a little storage deal under the house in a crawl space that we called the basement. He had expanded in there, and we'd go get in that. Not we were cowards. We weren't fearful. We were just, you know, there's tornadoes popping up everywhere in Dallas. We're gonna go get in the basement. And that's what I'm saying is you need that food there, the firearms, the medical supplies, an emergency plan if a nuke goes off or we start World War III with the Russians. Folks, you're not going to get your kids out of school when that happens. I mean, you got to be watching every day. You got to be ready. The globalists are digging in. They're going into bunkers. I don't know what's going on. There's a lot of threat levels, but I'm telling you, you need to get ready. And number one, get your gut right with God. So Mega Food Sales is extending it with twisted arms, 30 to 40% off. InfoWarsLife.com for all the nutraceuticals. 10% off all the preparedness items. And that includes all the nutraceuticals. I see those as from DNA Force to X2 Survival Shield, Iodine to Secret 12, Vitamin B12 to Winter Sun. And all this stuff stores a long time. It's great to have. Colloidal silver is always great to have. Additional 10% off when you get auto ship and free shipping on orders above $50. Anthroplex is back in stock. Super Male Vitality, a little bit more than we thought. It's about to sell out. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. And we'll also, when you get high-quality products at low prices, it'll help fund going to Cleveland, no matter how dangerous that is, I'm going. And everywhere else, and our reporters all over, you see them changing the narrative everywhere, getting the truth out about what happened in California. That boosted Trump a bunch of points. I'm not going to play the clip from a week ago where the very same State Department weasel gets up and says, "We never said we wouldn't have boots on the ground in Syria. That's ridiculous." And starts laughing at everyone. And they're sitting there with their mouths hanging open. And even the propaganda channel, USA Today, had to put 16 clips together. We played part of it. I'm not going to play the whole thing. Of Obama pledging, "I will never do it." They've since come out again and said people are lying. It didn't happen. I'm not going to play it. You know what happened. Or you can look it up. No one buys this. You people have a 6% trust rate. I mean, police. To where they have comedians at the White House press dinner, and Obama got so mad, pointing right at him, saying, "You're basically a murdering piece of trash, and Wolf Blitzer, you're a total fraud." Why would somebody have the courage to do that? Well, the guy's got soul. The guy's got courage. What's the comedian's name? It's my new hero. But right in a den of vipers, you can tell he didn't like him, too. The body language, he was sick. He was scared doing it, but he did it and manned up, which is a real man right there. Body language was perfect in that guy. I could really see he didn't like it. He could feel the evil. He did the right thing because he knows they're done. Now's the time to blow the rotting barn down. Now's the time to bury this political system of the devil. And believe me, folks, pardon me? Oh, yeah, Larry Wilmore. They're popping right now. No, I've got his name right here. Yeah, we can go over all this. They remind me to go to the clip. This is State Department clowns caught in a lie once again. This time by the Defense Department. Oh, you're talking about the name of the comedian. What's his name again? Larry Wilmore. I want to get him on. I love him. State Department clowns caught in a lie once again, this time by the Defense Department. Colonel Steve Warren, Operation Inherent Resolve spokesman, DOD briefing with Baghdad on April 20th stated that al-Nusra, that's al-Qaeda, in the primary group that is occupying Aleppo, the key city in Syria, the crossroads, on April 27th, State Department Deputy Mark Toner went on saying that al-Nusra is not holding Aleppo, which they are. On May 28th, State Department Representative Kirby, this is the one we're going to play, said that al-Qaeda control of Aleppo is better option than Syria army liberating from international recognized terrorists who committed 9/11, reportedly. That's May 2nd. So, I mean, whoa, they're admitting they're backing al-Qaeda, but first lying, first admitting it, the military telling the truth, saying it's a problem, then denying it, then coming and saying, okay, we did lie, but it's better for you. Whoa, whopper, whopper, whopper. And I'll say it's the army that's basically telling the truth. See, there's an and I'm not lionizing the army, but the army has decided, look, we're not backing al-Qaeda. No, we know you did it. We know criminals took the country. We're lining up against you. I've had the top experts on, the insiders who launched the whole operation against the globalists. People are getting killed behind the scenes. Just know that. Let's go to the clip.
Not under the exclusive control of Nusra. And there is the perception, and certainly this is something that the Syrian regime and the Russians have supported, that Aleppo is under Nusra control. Therefore, they can simply attack it, and they're going after known terrorist organizations.
It's primarily al-Nusra who holds Aleppo. And of course, al-Nusra not part of the cessation of hostilities.
You know, the expansion of Assad regime control inside Syria is not a good thing for the people of Syria writ large.
That's an al-Qaeda backer right there.
So, you know, talks about liberation, if you will, of Aleppo, or it's a falsehood.
Colonel Warren said a couple of days ago when he was talking about Aleppo, he said that Aleppo is primarily in the hands of al-Nusra. Is that a view here?
Well, I think, again, Mark talked to this. I mean, our view of Aleppo is that it's a very mixed, very fluid environment, and that the groups are intermingled, and that, you know, that's our view of it. Yeah.
It's primarily al-Nusra who holds Aleppo. And, of course, al-Nusra not part of the cessation of hostilities.
So the army goes, they're breaking the ceasefire. It's al-Nusra, al-Qaeda. They're bad. We need to take them out. And you got the State Department running around saying, no, that's not happening. These are traitors, folks. They need to be arrested. I'll tell you right now, the guy needs a trial, and they all need to get marched up there and get ropes put around their neck. Those al-Qaeda people have killed over 200,000 Christians in Syria in a war they started. My God, we're run by evil people, and they're bringing them in with sleeper cells to hit this country. I will not put up with this anymore. That son of a bitch, Glenn Beck, excuse me. You know, I'm really glad that Daria this morning said, have you seen this clip? And I've read about how the Pentagon and the Army particularly keeps saying, no, al-Nusra is al-Qaeda. That's admitted, and they're taking over everything, and we're giving them weapons, and we're not going to be part of this. We're not going to back them. That's the 4 years of the military behind the scenes refusing to do it and then giving Russians targeting on how to go after them. Total rebellion against the people that hijacked the country, because rebellion against a hijacker is your duty, because they're not the captain. They're not the lawful government. And I've told you with Colonel Schaefer and Dr. Steve Pachinik and countless others years ago, the epic battle where the U.S. Army particularly, and boy, the U.S. Army's done the dirty work, folks. It's one of the most highest kill count out there. I mean, when it comes to, sometimes it's like the assault on the road to Damascus. The army has come out in the last 4 years behind the scenes. We told you it was happening. But now publicly, after Benghazi and the rest of it, said, look, we're not giving weapons to al-Qaeda and ISIS. We're not going to murder Christians. We're not doing this. You people are crazy. And Saudi Arabia is crazy. What we've done to Iraq was wrong, and we apologize for it, and you better stop it. And the chairman of the Joint Chiefs went and told Obama 3 years ago, he said, we're not doing this air raid. We're not going to back al-Qaeda. Then Rand Paul came out and said, we're not al-Qaeda's Air Force. Cruz jumped on the bandwagon. Did some good things, talked about it, but only because it was already out. And now they keep trying to turn the country over to al-Nusra. That's the main group that is al-Qaeda. That's just their name in Syria. It's admitted. That's not debatable. And so we have this incredibly sensational clip that I just played that just is so amazing, where State Department deceiver caught in a lie once again, this time of the Defense Department. Well, it's not caught in a lie. They all know the players. The military, particularly the Army, is refusing to lie. just like they did on 9/11, leaking the info to Congress, who was really involved, 28 pages. See, they put the word out, we helped them, we got the word out, others did. Now it's known, and people across the board are, look at this Colonel Warren. I'm sure he's not perfect, nobody is, but he's not going to back Al-Qaeda murdering hundreds of thousands of people. He won't do it. Look at his face. He's a good guy. You can see he's good. But his actions prove it. This isn't a hard choice. We're not going to back Al-Qaeda. We're not going to sell baby parts. We're not going to put fluoride in the water. We're done. You understand that? I'm not afraid of the New World Order. I'm afraid of joining something like this and my soul being destroyed. You know, I don't believe in God. Just have fun. Do whatever you want. I can feel it, folks. Okay, I don't need to be churched on these issues. I know it. Thank God I'm not with you people. I'm not perfect, but let me tell you, I do not choose to hurt innocent people and to be an evil son of a piece of garbage. And I apologize I use a little deprecating language. It's nothing wrong if you're a kid from a single parent. Saying somebody's an SOB is not a good enough term for somebody like Obama or the New World Order or Al-Qaeda. But that really comes out because I just want to, that's the words that come out of me, and I'm trying to control myself. I've been on here 21 years and not ever used words like that hardly till lately because I'm so upset and I apologize. But I mean, I've got such resolve. It's beyond confidence when it comes to these people. I just metaphysically want to tear their arms and legs out of their sockets. I mean, these people are low, they're weak, they're stupid, they're wicked. And it's time for the sleeping giant that is free humanity to rise in an information war and defeat the occupiers. All right. I want to go back. I want to go to some cruise clips here in a minute, but I want to play this clip that I mentioned. You got ABC's Quantico, American terrorist cell, shouts, make America great again before they blow a bunch of Americans up. So Trump's going to bomb you now. People watch that and believe it. Yeah, down with Trump. He wants to blow us up. That's up on Infowars.com from Breitbart. It's up on DrudgeReport.com. You got this priesthood rising, crews running around saying divine intervention, save us. Oh, please, save us from Trump. Oh, it's so horrible. Oh, it's so terrible. Anything but Trump. Just the whole establishment against Trump. Boy, what is it about Trump they don't like? I'll say this. If Trump gets in and he is a bad guy, it's the greatest deception I've ever seen. The globalists don't like stuff to get out of control like this. They want to control it. This is real. They don't like Trump. That's real. But is it because he won't kiss their rear ends? See, I don't want Trump if that's just what it is, and he's not going through the regular channels. But I'm hoping it's something else. But regardless, it's about defeating populism, and it's about discrediting populism and nationalism. That's why I'm supporting Trump. I'm supporting Trump, so if he goes sideways on us or goes in reverse, I've got credibility, and I've been focused on it to really go after Trump. And that's something else that's known. Just letting you know where I come from. But the big clip I want to play here in just a moment, and then we'll play the ABC Quantico, is State Department clowns, that is Ringwraiths, caught in a lie once again, this time of the Defense Department. This is one of the most epic clips ever. I never play clips two or three times in a row, but here it is. Played it last hour. Colonel Steve Warren, a patriot, Operation Inherent Resolve spokesman, DOD, briefing from Baghdad April 20th, stated that al-Nusra is the primary group that is occupying Aleppo. On April 27th, State Department Deputy Mark Toner went on saying that al-Nusra is not holding Aleppo. On May 28th, State Department Rep Kirby, the worst ever, said that al-Qaeda control of Aleppo is better than Syrian army liberating it from internationally recognized terrorists who were involved in 9/11, bare minimum. May 2nd. That's today. Or yesterday, May 3rd. It's today. What an epic, I mean, this video, I talk about skeleton keys or Rosetta Stones or Philosopher Stones that you can decode stuff with. This is so big because believe me, it's been in the news everywhere that they have gone over the Army, over the Navy, over the Marine Corps, over the Air Force. But the Army really is the biggest force on the ground. So that's who's doing all this. And they're saying, listen, stop saying al-Qaeda's in Syria. Stop saying that al-Nusra is al-Qaeda. Stop saying ISIS is al-Qaeda. When they all have the same flag, they change the name to confuse everybody. We're going to court-martial you, and the whole Army basically said, you know what, go ahead and do that. We're not backing al-Qaeda. We're not their Air Force. We're not going to cut people's heads off. This all started 4 or 5 years ago when out of Benghazi, they would ship the arms up to Syria, and U.S. Special Forces would offload when the C-130s landed to people in the deck of cards from Al-Qaeda. And they were like, there were army colonels going, what in the earth? And these guys would, these jihadis are so arrogant. They're not controlled by the West. They're just protected. They would, I've talked to folks that were there. I mean, I've had them on air. You've heard them, Plumlee and others. They would shoot their mouths off and go, screw you. And they're all kind of like gangster hip hop. They're like, we're going to F you up. G, get ready. We're going to kill you. Blow your family up. Because that's all the English they know. And the troops are like, what the? And they're just, you're under orders on the, you know, on the sat phone. Deliver them the, you know, the TOW missiles and the anti-aircraft guns. And they're just like, their whole worldview is just smashed. They're like, that's how arrogant Obama and these people are, is they'd send special forces officers to deliver weapons in hundreds of deliveries to the filth of the earth. And now that's all come out. I told you about it 4 years ago. Now it's in the news. So we've got army colonels who are the spokesperson for the whole operation in Syria going, yeah, we've got al-Nusra, that's al-Qaeda, taking over. And we think, you know, the whole full briefing, we think we should, you know, take them out. No. Then they have the State Department come out and say, who's a former Pentagon spokesman, and go, the same guy that said a week ago that we never said there wouldn't be boots on the ground, which Obama said 16 times. And he says, okay, well, first they say it isn't happening. Then they say, you know what? We want al-Nusra instead of Assad. Assad attacked no one. Assad was democratizing. Assad was working with the West, just like Gaddafi. They try to get these guys to come in, work with the West, and they backstab them. Do you know what that'll mean in every future negotiation with America's soft power? It's over. And the globalists aren't stupid. They are discrediting us as the superpower right now. You don't think the army is just a bunch of sweetie pies that are perfect little soldiers and are mad we're aiding al-Qaeda? They're mad about that, but they know there is a plan to discredit us worldwide right now and take the country down. They know they're trying to arrest all the patriots and members of Congress that won't sell the country out. And the army's sitting around going, we're aiding al-Qaeda to kill Christians. We're preparing to take down America, shut down our power plants, arrest all these talk show hosts and governors. You know what? We got a mission. Let's go out and get the word out and leak it however we can, and let's get together. Good. You did something. You salvaged your honor. And such an epic moment to be alive, ladies and gentlemen. Do people realize what they're seeing? Yeah, I'm a father, and I love my children. I want to be around for them. But I know people end up taking care of my kids no matter what happens. I got great parents and others. God will work it out. And it's such a feeling to just not even worry about what happens to me telling the truth, because there's no future if we don't anyways. That's a great feeling of freedom, isn't it? Because we don't become men until we're committed all the way to realize there is no future unless we put in 110% against these people. And my full will and soul is against the New World Order. And I beg Christ for the strength and perseverance to follow through on all that's got to be done. We are facing the most evil people the world's ever seen. And I just ask you to get right with God and do whatever God guides you to do to commit peacefully in the info war to discredit these rats that think they've got us. Because I'm telling you, their delusion is going to be their downfall. They've miscalculated. Let's go ahead and play this clip. Where first we have the colonel. Then we have the State Department. Mark Toner went on saying al-Nusra is not holding, just a denial. This is not happening. To the true evil, the State Department coming out with this creature. God, I mean, the dishonor of State Department head spokesman Kirby. I mean, can you imagine it? Can you imagine being this horrible monster backing al-Qaeda, al-Nusra, with what they're doing? Enslaving, selling women as slaves, chopping people's heads off, blowing up non-radical mosques, killing the Catholics, killing the ancient Orthodox Christians by the hundreds of thousands, forcing fathers to suicide bomb or they kill their families. He sits up there giggling and laughing about it because he thinks he's powerful, because he's allied with evil. God is going to crush you. I don't take any pleasure in that. I don't like seeing God step on a pile of horse crap. Let's go to the clip.
Aleppo is not under the exclusive control of Nusra. And there is the perception, and certainly this is something that the Syrian regime and the Russians have supported that Aleppo is under Nusra control, therefore they can simply attack it, and they're going after unknown terrorist organizations.
It's primarily al-Nusra who holds Aleppo.
That's the army term.
And of course al-Nusra not part of the cessation of hostilities.
You know, the expansion of Assad regime control inside Syria is not a good thing for the people of Syria writ large.
This is Kirby.
Talks about this liberation, if you will, of Aleppo, or it's a falsehood.
Colonel Warren said a couple of days ago when he was talking about Aleppo, he said that Aleppo's primarily in the hands of al-Nusra. Is that a view here?
Well, I think, again, Mark talked to this. I mean, our view of Aleppo is that it's a very mixed, very fluid environment, and that the groups are intermingled, and that, you know, that's our view of it. Yeah.
It's primarily al-Nusra who holds Aleppo. And, of course, al-Nusra not part of the cessation of hostilities.
They're running an al-Qaeda takeover of Syria. They changed the name to confuse everybody. The army comes out and tells the truth. Everybody's like, oh, look, the army exposed the lie. No, the army is directly contravening the foreigners, the Vichy French, if you will, that have... I mean, we are literally occupied by globalists. You understand? It's not rhetoric, people, that are allied with al-Qaeda, Saudi Arabia, bringing in millions of people in Europe, the United States, and other areas as sleeper cells, giving them weapons. And when they attack, they will take all of our rights or arrest us, claiming we made them attack because we wouldn't put hoods on our wives' heads. I mean, these are the filth of the earth we're up against. I'm going to give the number out when we come back. Get into other news. Take your phone call straight ahead. The Lord Moncton joins us in the next hour. All right, the toll-free number to join us coming up in the next two segments is 800-259-9231. What do you think about the campaign? What do you think about ABC TV coming out with Make America Great Again? America First, saying that's what terrorists do when they blow stuff up, is creating this preparation for false flags. 800-259-9231. North Korea invasion, Kim's master plan will leave a million dead. I'm going to be getting into that, so much more, but I want to play some clips of Cruz demonizing Trump here in a moment. But first, let's play Trump, what was it, yesterday in Indiana. And this is what scares him. I mean, China is screwing us over. China does have a devalued currency, no environmental standards, all sorts of crud. They then lobby here in the U.S. for more regulations on us and carbon taxes on us, as if 35 to 40% currency tariffs and environmental tariffs and the rest of it isn't enough to shut us down. Now they want carbon taxes on us, but not on them. So he says, look, we're being raped here. And the Chinese communists are all moving to the U.S. They're not even giving any money, a living wage, to the average Chinese worker, getting about a half dollar an hour. So that's what this is. This is rape. It's communists using their giant population. They're raping. The most abused people in the world are Chinese, super smart, super hardworking. Our CIA went in, put Mao in 49. It's declassified. I apologize to the Chinese. I mean, I really do. I don't just want to apologize as social justice, you know, signaling, or to, you know, see a black person apologize for white people because I want to feel good about myself. I mean, I want to apologize to Russia that our forebears had bankers that ran this country that put the Bolsheviks in. I want to apologize to the Chinese for Mao Zedong that we have a criminal CIA that did that. I want to apologize. Even though I wasn't alive and did it, I just want to say my forebears were good people. They were ignorant. They didn't know what was going on. It was too sophisticated. They were a bunch of good people, but they were just the level of evil is hard to imagine. But we know now. And I'm doing everything I can to expose it. By the way, Russia's not perfect, but you know it's in popular literature in Russia, and Solzhenitsyn, and Putin's a big follower of him and all the rest of it. And it's really happening. Putin's this big. He's a Christian publicly, but that's really what's happened, folks. And they all know the globalists did it. They know the whole history, and the Russians are absolutely flipping out right now. Imagine when we wake up. I'm telling you, the globalists are scared for a reason. Humanity is rising. We're rising. I want China to be free. I want Russia to be free. I want Africa to be free. All those nations. I want Latin America. I want everybody to succeed and be successful. I believe in humanity. These parasites hate your guts, and they hate Trump because he knows what's going on. Let's play the Trump clip.
$500 billion deficit, trade deficit with China. We're going to turn it around. And we have the cards. Don't forget, we're like the piggy bank that's being robbed. We have the cards. We have a lot of power with China. When China doesn't want to fix the problem in North Korea, we say, sorry, folks, you got to fix the problem. Because we can't continue to allow China to rape our country. And that's what they're doing. It's the greatest theft in the history of the world.
And that's what it is. 45, 50 billion a month with select globalists that went in there with the Bushes and made deals. You know, Kissinger is really evil. Nixon did some bad stuff. And the worst thing he did was that secret deal with China. But I got to tell you, he didn't have the full scope of it. That's why they got rid of Nixon. He was trying to have a real deal. Thought he was president, so they got him for breaking into the psychiatrist office of who was running against. I mean, give me a break. How about funding al-Qaeda to take over Syria to kill 300,000 people? How about setting up Libya and killing 50, 60,000 people just in the first invasion? I mean, you know, it's just, it comes down to that. You know, send somebody to prison for a crooked toenail, but let somebody rape kids, basically. We're going to go to break. I'm going to come back to the next long segment and take your calls. First, I'm going to play some clips of Ted Cruz. And by the way, let's get something clear. I don't enjoy demonizing somebody that I've kind of given a pass to, hoping they'd be good. I feel sick when I attack Ted Cruz. I don't like saying bad things about people. When I call somebody trash or evil, when George Will says, your election means nothing, you never had a vote, you're nobody, we are the sovereigns, he said that. I have to call him out as a bottom-of-the-barrel, anti-human enemy, and I have to give my essence towards hating him. When I really start hating somebody, it's real deep. These people are your enemy, folks. You have to understand that they hate you and your family. They want to torture and deform your children. They get off on all the deformed kids and the record infant mortality and all the retarded people everywhere and the autistic kids. They go, don't use the word retarded. They retard your children and then say, don't use the word retarded in their sick humor. We're going to get you people. You understand that, you pieces of filth? Every stinking one of you. When we're done with you, you're not going to like what happens. I'll tell you that. And I don't say that with any pleasure. But you little scared pieces of crap need to know this. You're not going to screw us over and get away with it. You're not going to hurt children and get away with it. The men are coming for you. Get that straight. ABC TV. Hey, make America great. Make America first means you blow buildings up. That's the message. We're going to attack you. We're going to say you're a terrorist. We're going to try to get you arrested or fired. Oh, mother in Colorado talks about chemtrails and makes a video about it. So she loses her daughter. And the judge says, that's a weird culture. I'm going to have your kids taken. See, this is the system we're going into. I'm going to go back to that in your phone calls. John and Matt and Tom and Carlos and Nelson and others. Toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. I've been pretty, not emotional today, but I'm somebody that's a realist. And I look at all the genetic engineering, and I look at all the bizarre behavior going on, and I look at all the wars being started. I look at our government hijacked by foreign interest, backing the most horrible, evil people, doing just despicable, evil things in mass. And I study the elite, and I go, these people are best described as demons. I don't know if demons are real, but they're real because you're a demon. And then my gut sense is it's accelerating, it's getting worse, it's building up. And my gut's never been wrong my whole life. I mean, I almost always follow my gut now. Used to, I didn't follow at all. And as I get older, I just say, gut runs the show. I'll intellectually look at what the gut's saying, and I always find the gut's right. I mean, my gut is never wrong. And the nose knows. You can just see the stuff going on everywhere, but it's just wild. I want to go to your phone calls here, and I want to play a few Trump clips first, but the best thing all of us can do is spread the word about media outlets and organizations that care about freedom. If you're listening to us on a local AM or FM affiliate, that station out of 15,000 stations, we're only on close to 170, 80 stations or so. is bucking the entire curve, the entire system. They're going through all sorts of bull to put us on. It's just amazing what the establishment does, how the big networks operate, how the advertising combines operate. You should just know that person, that group, that owner, that station is going through a lot. Support them. Become a sponsor. Send them $100. I mean, this is a war, folks. The preciousness but of any outlet we have, but even more important, tell people about the station. This is epic stuff. This isn't just one more view or one more guy on the radio. Anybody that's been listening a while knows we've got our finger on the zeitgeist. Believe me, it's exhausting, but it's also invigorating. I don't want to be at the zeitgeist, at the fount. For whatever reason, we are. And I have a tender heart. I know you have a tender heart, but I'm also a man, and I can come off as aggressive and hateful and mean. This is a man wanting to defend the tender, innocent people. I do have a lot of feelings of anger and of rage and of commitment. But I realize physicality, some guy tries to mug you in a parking lot with your kids. Yeah, that's where physicality comes in. But this is a larger enemy I fight. A larger enemy you fight. It's about brains. It's about will. It's about strength. It's about commitment. It's about long-term fight. And in that fight, we find the animating spirit of liberty that God gave us. We find ourselves in the darkness. We find that light that God gave us in our heart. And I know that we, as liberty lovers, are kindred spirits. Because we belong to God. And a lot of times, we're humble, we're ashamed of ourselves because we are conscious. But the fact that we love God transcends all of our worldliness. And as long as we take action against evil, that's all God's looking for. And you already know that truth written on your heart, written on your mind, your soul. God knew you before you were formed in your mother's womb. Great evil is being launched against humanity right now. I think they're going to new levels. I see the evidence in the vaccines. They are now attacking consciousness itself. They're now going after free will itself with the additives in the food and water. They're going to a new level right now. And I can feel God's rage. The God-fearing in me shakes to my very core. Because the big volcano is getting ready to erupt. And the petulant, evil people have taken God's leniency as weakness. God's kindness is weakness. God's restraint is weakness. Have sowed the wind, and they will reap the whirlwind. But in that fiery blast of judgment, don't think that all of us will be spared. But isn't it a great honor? Like a bowling ball thrown against the enemy to knock over all the pins? Isn't it the weapon God throws against the enemy that's the most honored? That's where all of us should want to be. Because the devil deceives and twists people and leads them into darknesses. God uses free will and those that choose to commit until the end, no matter how high the price may be, to go on and to never surrender. To paraphrase Winston Churchill, we shall fight in the fields, we shall fight in the streets, we shall fight with growing strength and confidence in the air, we shall fight in the mountains, we shall fight in the ravines, we shall fight across the world and never surrender. Not that Winston Churchill was perfect. The point is, the speech is true. We shall go on to the end. Whatever the cost may be, we'll never surrender. I'm going to go to your phone calls. I'm going to play these clips briefly. I'm not going to belabor this. We fund ourselves selling really good stuff, like vitamin B12 of the purest organic form out there, patented, that is the most absorbable other than injectable. That's our research. Secret 12 is amazing. There's studies out about depression and mental activity and mental illness and schizophrenia with folks that don't get enough vitamin B12. And a lot of it's gut flora problems with the pesticides and the rest of it that you can't absorb it. So you need to get it by injection, going to a doctor, or you need to get it under the tongue. And, you know, I've been taking a lot of vitamin B12. You supposedly can't OD on it, but I tell you, my brain works a lot better on it. It's, quite frankly, transcendent. I've been taking a lot of vitamin B12, I'll just tell you right now. And you can look at the studies that are out there on it. Vitamin B12 deficiency linked to depression, Alzheimer's, I mean, schizophrenia. Look it up for yourself. I mean, the point is you need vitamin B12. We also have 30 to 40% off. I'm just still extending it because people are really taking action. That's a good thing. On the InfoWarsSelect.com or InfoWarsStore.com, high-quality storable foods, very clean, very good, very fresh, 25-year shelf life. That mega sells all survival goods, which includes all the nutraceuticals from DNA Forest to X2 to Anthroplex, 10% off. 10% off additionally with auto ship, free shipping on orders above $50, so just specials all over the place. We also have Winter Sun. That's a really good organic form of vitamin D3. Quite frankly, sunlight's what you need. So there's a new big study out on that. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, or 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. That's at InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com. There's InfoWarsHealth.com. That's the longevity products, InfoWarsHealth.com. That's a whole other line of great products that I endorse, and you buy it there. That supports us, have some of the biggest discounts there you can find on those products as well. And that's how we fund the operation. But the enemy wants you dependent. The enemy wants you unhealthy. The enemy doesn't want you to be able to persevere like the ant, not the grasshopper, who doesn't prepare for the long winter. We hope this time isn't getting worse, but you see what's happening in the rest of the world. It's a smart move to get prepared. InfoWarsStore.com for all the items. 10% off on storable foods, or 30 to 40% off, but 10% off on the non-GMO, heirloom, non-hybrid seeds, giant spectrum of those. Already the lowest prices, 10% off on that, and basically everything out there that's preparedness related on top of 30-40% off, InfoWarsStore.com. Okay, enough ranting for me. Let's go ahead and play these clips and then go to phone calls. There's a bunch of these. Let's play somebody. What's the first clip, Dari? I've got so many. That's right, Lion Ted clip. And then I'm just going to let you play each clip and then I'll comment briefly after. Here it is.
Let me ask you something, sir. What do you like about Donald?
Everything.
Give me one.
Everything.
Give me one. Money. Maybe pick any.
The wall.
Okay, the wall.
That's the main thing. All right. Immigration.
Ted's building the wall.
All right, hold on a second. Now, do you know on the wall that Donald told the New York Times editorial board he's not going to build a wall and he's not going to deport anyone?
You're lying. Once again, lying Ted.
Well, sir, you know, actually...
So he says Donald isn't really going to build the wall. Never said he would not build the wall. Let's go to the next clip.
Trump, I have spent 20 years fighting to defend the Second Amendment. And I'll tell you this, sir. If Donald Trump ever becomes president, he has said on the Supreme Court he's going to cut a deal with Chuck Schumer. He said that in two debates ago, which means he's going to put a liberal on the Supreme Court. He's going to take away your Second Amendment right. There is a reason why Gun Owners of America has endorsed me in this campaign, because I've defended the Second Amendment my whole life, while Donald Trump is a New York liberal who will take away your Second Amendment rights. This man is lying to you, and he's taking advantage of you.
Let me add to that. I love gun owners. I love Larry Pratt. I get why they're going with Cruz as the on record, the more conservative guy, at least when his voting record. But the background is there. Cruz can say these things, but Trump is on record saying he's a constructionist and would appoint people like Scalia or even more conservative. And his rhetoric is clear. If he betrays us, we'll go after him. But we know where the Bushes that are backing Cruz have been, and they're anti-gun. Bush, Herbert Walker, and George W. supported the assault weapons ban, you name it. So don't we have Trump responding to that too, don't we? Yeah, let's play Trump responding to that in a moment, then we'll go to the next clip. But here's Trump responding to that.
I think I'll be able to get along well with Schumer, Chuck Schumer. I was always very good with Schumer. I was close to Schumer in many ways. And, you know, it's important that you get along. It's wonderful to say you're a maverick and you're going to stand up and you're going to close up the country and all of the things. But you got to get somebody to go along with you. You know, you have a lot of people. We have a system. The founders created a system that actually is a very good system. It does work. But it can't work if you can get nobody to go along with you. And that's the problem that you have with Ted Cruz. He's a guy that nobody likes and nobody trusts, and he is a nasty guy. He says things that are very nasty.
All right. I mean, I can't stand Chuck Schumer, but Trump's in New York. That's the senator of New York, senior senator. Hillary was there as well. You got to work with them when they come after you. And he said that. He didn't like the system. But he's not compromising the Second Amendment, and he's not compromised. He gets them to compromise. And that I agree with. Let's go ahead and go to the next clip. And then we're going to go to break and probably go to your calls even before we go to break. But there's a lot of these up on Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. Here's the deal. He's got such a populist movement behind him of libertarians and patriots and conservatives that if Trump doesn't deliver, it won't be like Obama with his idiot followers that just shut up about it. Trump will be impeached. He will be sued. He will be anathema. He will be gone after. He's not a sleeper cell, in my view, because of how scared the system is. They are literally doing everything they can to stop him. And so that's why I am supporting Trump. He's not perfect, but he is, a symbol of populism. And Cruz lying and saying Trump's causing the rioting when the White House and the Soros groups and the Mecha and La Raza and Black Lives Matter are attacking, he's doing that again today. It's not Trump causing that. It's not Trump doing that. That's a lie. And the Ben Carson stunt. People can say, well, just don't bet on anybody then. Just sit back and say, I don't trust any of them. Well, I can feel like an intellectual elitist doing that, not getting the arena. No. The system's scared of Trump. He's a nationalist across the board. He hates political correctness. I'm betting on him with a proviso that I don't totally think he's perfect and that we're going to be there to keep him honest. But regardless, we're going to get people elected at the state level, the county level, the city level, the federal level. This is an all-out move against the globalists. So even if they have to pose as a patriot with Donald Trump, it shows we're winning. They try to then defeat him, discredit populism, then that's a problem. This is very sophisticated. I want to go to John and in Maryland, then Matt and others. John in Maryland, you're on the air. Welcome.
Hello, Alex. How you doing?
I'm all right, brother. Go ahead.
Well, I have a comment and a question. The comment's real simple. I've not watched the Glenn Beck show or listened to his radio program in 2-3 years. The other day I was perusing around looking for some campaign information, and out of 45 minutes, almost 30 of it was, you're a crazy person, specifically you. I don't mind anybody calling you crazy, but truth is you've been proven right more often than not. And it really reminded me of the liberals and the protesters screaming racist, 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 and not wanting to back anything up.
Well, here's the deal. I mean, look, they always say that the wise king, a witch, it's a parable, poisoned a well to make everybody evil and psychotic. And the wise king woke up, everybody was evil and psychotic, he went and drank from the well. He was the only one who hadn't drank from it, he had his own water, so he became psychotic, everything was okay. Well, I'm more wise than that. If the Nazis in 1940 were saying I was crazy because I wasn't going along with them, I'm glad to be crazy. Harvard admits fluoride's causing massive cancer, brain damage, infertility. That's Reuters. Well, I said that 20 years ago. I've had the scientist on. Glenn Beck wants to use the term I'm crazy. He's desperate. He's scared. He wants to try to discredit people using Alex Jones. That's because they're so scared of what I say, they run towards it to make fun of it. It's like vampires are scared of the light. They're like, I'm not scared of the light. I go out in the noon all the time. The noon sun's crazy. It doesn't hurt me, but he's down in his basement hiding from me. I'm fully aware he's attacking me. I get the emails and stuff. And it's all his listeners leaving him. Almost all the emails are, God, he's crazy. We hate him. He thinks he's God now. So just forget Glenn Beck. He's going bankrupt in his own admission. He's a joke. He's destroyed. And he just sits around studying how to BS people all day instead of just being real and profound, and that's trumps everything. That's the ace of spades, punk. And so I don't have a personal beef with him. I'm very sad that he's so low. But yeah, calling me crazy all day, yeah, I'm crazy like a fox. And crazy that I love freedom. Go ahead.
Maybe the emperor has no clothes after all. My question is this. I am really scared of one thing. I see so many parallels of RFK and Trump coming up. What do you think? They're trying to steal elections. They're trying to throw the voice of the people down. What do you think is going to happen if we have another repeat of California Convention and RFK.
Well, I don't want to make a big issue out of it, but I've got a real gut issue with Cleveland. My danger zone, Spidey sense is just like just never been slamming the needle like it is. And I think Trump's for real. His spirit scares him. He just wants to eat cheeseburgers and have a wealthy country and not screw America. He doesn't hate America. He doesn't have it out for the country. He's not even perfect. He just doesn't hate America. He was brought up, and they hate this country. And they're coming after us. And yeah, I think the detonator is they could kill Trump, stage false flags, and claim his supporters did it. They've got TV shows and movies saying Trump supporters are going to blow up federal buildings. I mean, folks, they got TV shows saying it's coming for the lemmings. And then when it happens, duh, they're preparing everybody. It's so stupid. It's so obvious. And so, no, I think it's in the cards. You know, I think you've been playing poker for 5 hours. You've never seen the ace of spades yet. You've never seen the ace of hearts. You've never seen the ace of clubs. This guy's probably keeping them in his hand. In fact, I'm pretty sure they got them. We got God, so it doesn't matter in the final equation. Everything the enemy does at this level, this is a no-holds-bar death battle. And no, let me tell you, they got the assassination teams ready. They got schizophrenics ready, wound up, drugged up to let them into the meeting. They've got assassination teams 24/7 ready to kill Trump. And Trump knows that. Trump, for a month, went to Scotland, reportedly. I heard about this before it was in the political, 6 months before, was gone for a month and just came back and said, I'm not going to do it. And then he looked at his son, who's autistic from vaccines, and he looked at them carving the country up. He looked at poor people. He's kind of an egomaniac. He hates seeing poor people. He hates not seeing prosperity. And it's just this classic Americana idea that his immigrant parents put into him. And he just said no. I mean, why do they want to screw us? This is BS. He's kind of a thug at certain levels, but he doesn't hate America. He doesn't hate prosperity. He doesn't hate people that are successful. He likes it. And so they want to kill him. They want to kill me. They want to kill your future. They hate us all. They're a bunch of thugs that hate us, who squat on top of us like the communist Chinese with their mobile death vans, and 84 million killed under Mao, another 20 million killed under other Chinese communists. And they say, you can't have him. We said so. He's a racist. I mean, a bunch of murdering grand champion filth telling us what to do. I mean, it's just an over-the-top megalomania delusion of these people. And, John, I totally agree with you. I think it's about 70% odds there's going to be an attempt on his life by the voting day of the general election. And I think there's about a 40% chance they're going to kill Donald Trump deader than a hammer. And then I think they're going to blow stuff up and say that his listeners did it, and just have leftist communists run around and shoot every cop on the street they find and just burn everything as they hop around and just piss on everything. It's just all the miserable, decadent scum loves evil. And they just dream that in some fiery inferno, they're going to find power because they never had honor in their life. So they think in some blood orgy, they're going to find it. And all they're going to find in a blood orgy is patriots defending their families, mowing them down in defense. So what do you say to that, John?
Keep up the good fight. That's all that we can do, because it's going down.
Yeah, this is world government. This is it. And even if Trump is just a beginning tremor, I mean, you can just see your gut, your intellect, everything. It's like in Star Trek when they're getting attacked and it's there's fire shooting out of the console. I mean, I don't know what's hitting us, but it's bad. I mean, I just don't drink their water, folks. Don't eat their GMO and don't take their shots. I mean, all people are suddenly acting mentally ill, retarded, dumbed out. I mean, all the people suddenly that I've known for years can't talk and are just like, ooh. It's like we're getting hit with some bad stuff. I don't know what it is, but everybody sees that they're still conscious, and just pray for your consciousness. Pray for your consciousness, folks. That's all I can ask, is just pray for consciousness. Pray that the enemy... They got viruses they admit that eat parts of the cerebral cortex. It's viral lobotomies. It's just, that's what's going on. I'll just be frank with you. And the psychopaths hopping around everywhere, getting off on it. It's over the top. I'm sorry, stuff's so epic. Matt, let's talk to the folks in New York. Matt, you're on the air.
Hello, Alex.
Yes, sir.
So, my girlfriend, Allie, who's a listener too, has a theory on Bernie Sanders. And that's that. He's being used to get a large, trendy base of voters so that when Hillary gets the nomination, she can pick Bernie as her running mate to steal the election from Trump. Because they have to make it plausible that she beats Trump, and by taking Sanders as her running mate, it makes the deal more plausible. What do you think?
I think that'd be a great move for Hillary.
It's kind of scary.
But notice, it's every other country's in endgame right now. Every other country's got the same weirdness going on. This is a takeover. This is a multi-thousand-year globalist, satanically influenced plan. You are witnessing interdimensional consciousness that the Bible warns of. This is what it's like to face the enemy. But we also have our own divine, beyond the enemy's discernment. So that's why you just got to call on God. But God's free will, the devil's not. You got to say, God, I can't handle this. I need you to come into my life right now to deal with this. And God will do it. Anything else,
Amen,
Matt?
Brother. That was pretty much it. I know you don't like people to thank you, but I really appreciate what you.
Well, thank you. The point is, though, I'm just in a fight for my family. It's very humbling, your support. I love everybody. You know, from these basset hounds and the story that are with this little brain dead baby and won't leave its side, you know, it won't eat, to just anything else that has empathy and humanity. And it's sad that dogs, on average, have more humanity than humans do, because we've been dehumanized, we've been destroyed, we've been rendered down, we've been born into a lie. But it's the great contest that animates us. This is the great test that separates the wheat from the chaff, the metal from the trash. Tom in the great north of Canada, Her Britannic Majesty's holding. Tom, you're on the air.
Hey, Alex. Just saw a Young Turks video a little while ago, and Cenk Uygur was saying that he's smarter than you and that maybe you're a little bit of a wimp. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I mean, he's got a name of the Young Turks that killed over a million ethnic Albanians for no reason. So he thinks we're all dumb when he uses the name of a mass murdering crew of psychopathic killers that went after Christians. So I think he tells us who he is, doesn't he?
Yeah, fair point. Also, he made that majesty comment. So you still think the British elites got a lot of influence in Canada, eh? I tend to agree.
Yeah, when your prime ministers don't do what they say, they suspend parliament and the Queen's governor comes in and puts in who she wants. Yeah, the Queen of England's the biggest landowner in the world. The Transylvanian Queen rules.
About that, on this side of the border. But another question for you. What are your thoughts on the Rwandan genocide? How come you never talk about that?
I made a film about it. I'm going to come back and talk to you because you need to be talked to. I never talked about the Rwandan Hutu Tutsi genocide the UN ran.
Thank you for listening.
Made actually two films on that, and that's just another UN genocide. What a bizarre statement, but I guess that's all you've got, Deception. No matter who Donald Trump really is, he's got the globalist, the kleptocrats scared. He's hard charging for nationalism, capitalism, and not letting communist China and the communist Pope establish their authoritarian world government. Lord Christopher Monckton joins us coming up in the next segment. Tom in Canada called in, and he said, why aren't you covering the Rwandan genocide of, I guess, 1993? And I made films about it. I've covered it. My film, America Destroyed by Design, exposes it. Some of the others do. I show the UN peacekeepers their own photos torturing children to death. And I've talked about how the UN has these great war crimes around the world, and why are they exempt with diplomatic immunity? But I didn't commit the war crimes. Let's say I'd never covered the Rwandan genocide. Let me ask Tom, is the Rwandan genocide my fault? What do you mean, why haven't I covered it?
Oh, no, I wasn't really accusing you. Like, you sound a little defensive there, but I just wanted to...
No, I'm not defensive. You said, why haven't I covered the Rwandan genocide? Yeah. I mean, who's covered that hardly? I mean, I've made films about it, written about it, said it's a horrible tragedy, covered it, not written hundreds of articles, my crew has. And so use a word like defensive. I mean, I'm very scared of you and your intellect right now. I'm so sorry. Yes, you're right. You've got me on my heels here. Tom, are you defending the UN's genocide operations worldwide for carbon sinks?
Oh, wow. Absolutely not. All I got to say about that is that it's just sad, and that's all there really is to it.
Do you take opiates, Tom?
No, I don't. Why is that?
You sound drunk. You don't sound like you're there.
Oh, no, I'm here. But, yeah, thanks for having me on, Alex.
All right, well, thank you for calling in. You know, we cover the UN's war crimes a lot. Do you think it's good the UN has diplomatic immunity? Who gives that to them?
I'd say billionaires. You know, billionaires and heads of state got the most influence, so I'd say...
Yeah, and they give themselves diplomatic immunity. They don't have that. I don't care if that Hitler gives himself to diplomatic immunity. He doesn't have it. Well, what do you think about the general state of the world? What do you think about Donald Trump?
I like Trump. I think he's good at talking, for sure. He's really got the gift of gab, and I enjoy listening to him talk. And I'd say probably he's better than Cruz. And regarding that whole election, though, in every other country, the party elites just choose the candidate. Why does it take so long in America? Why do you guys go through all that?
Well, normally the Republicans just put up who they want, finance it, then people popularly vote. They put laws in their own regulations to steal elections, but the public election is taxpayer-funded. It's a fraud to say popular vote doesn't count. They just tried to sell that idea, but people are roundly rejecting it, so that's very, very good news. Thank you, Tom. Let's go ahead and take one more call before Lord Moncton joins us. Let's go ahead and take another call. Carlos in California, you're on the air.
Yes, good morning, Alex. I haven't talked to you in a few years. But anyway, you know, on this China thing, the super elite sent Henry Kissinger to go out there and make a pact with Mao Zedong, who was backed by the OSS, by the way.
Yes.
He was put in power by the OSS.
Well, people don't know. From my research, the CIA, but sure. Same people.
CIA, yeah. But anyway, he made a pact with them that we were going to start unloading our industry to China, that they would become the producers, and we would become the consumers. Of course, this is going to take place in a, you know, gradually over the span of years. And so that was the pact that was made by the elite through Henry Kissinger. But then in the 90s, of course, you know, Bill Clinton started sending... technology to upgrade their...
That's right. They weren't supposed to be military. They were supposed to stay in their own area, and China's been breaking the pact. The globalists double-crossed America, as they always plan to in phase two. Stay there, because you can. Carlos, I'm going to go back to you when I go to Lord Moncton on this subject. But first, we're going to cover with Lord Moncton the UK leaving the EU straight ahead, the latest global carbon taxes to selectively shut down industry, and how to defeat the anti-human, eugenics-based world government. I'm Alex Jones. The Brexit is happening. The UK is pulling out of an organization that makes the vast majority of its laws outside of law and doesn't even have an elected government, has a ceremonial parliament that is being more and more dominated by UKIP, an organization founded by Patriot, Nigel Farage, and other folks involved like Lord Moncton, who has the website scienceofpublicpolicy.org. He was a top advisor to Margaret Thatcher, inventor, newspaper editor, you name it. And he's a classical architect, trained orator, high priest of climate skepticism. Lord Moncton was skeptical advisor to Margaret Thatcher as UK Prime Minister from 82 to 86. On leaving 10 Downing Street, he established a successful specialist consultancy company giving technical advice to corporations and governments. Lord Moncton's knowledge of science and politics began behind global warming is noted for its breadth and depth. He's given speeches all over the world and in films, you name it. They call for his arrest openly. They are now calling for the arrest of anyone challenging man-made climate change. No longer warming. Scienceofpublicpolicy.org. Also, whatsupwiththat.com. He frequently writes for. And I wanted to get him on, though, not about, because he'll go over the science and the proof and the sun is heating us. Oh, I know the scientists say that. I get it. It's like saying, you know, if you pour gasoline on something and strike a match, it's going to be on fire. I mean, I get it. Gasoline runs a car, too. The sky's blue, water's wet, fish swim in the ocean. But that's why he's a conspiracy theorist, folks. He says things like 2 + 2 = 4. But the reason I wanted to get him on today and take some of your calls coming up is this is seismic. To have UKIP around a few decades and now go from nowhere to fastest growing party in Europe and the UK, that's in the news. I'm not kidding. Look it up. And it's basically like a libertarian, nationalist, patriot organization. I would even say it's as hardcore as somebody like Donald Trump. It's just, hey, we shouldn't have one-sided trade deals. Hey, EU bureaucrats shouldn't make the most of our laws, it's almost 90% now, keeps growing. And even the liberal mayor of London's coming out sounding like Lord Monckton. I mean, this is exciting. I don't want to say we have victory, but we are turning the tide. I think that's a fair statement. The problem is we're turning the tide of public opinion and ideas, but they don't care. They're going full authoritarian, in my view. Lord Monckton, Christopher Monckton will correct me if he thinks I'm wrong, but I want to get into EU referendum poll tracker. Is Britain heading for the Brexit? And what does the UK think of Europe? Well, it's not Europe. It's not like you're against Spain or France or Germany. That's hijacked, too. And then let's bring in 5 million people the last 3 years and arrest you if you criticize radical Muslims being able to rape women. I mean, this is getting crazy. Then we enter the mental illness of the left to ally with any group who wants to bring down classical capitalism or what's left of it. I've seen this in crazy people. Even if they're smart and have power, they will destroy themselves in some will to dominate someone else. And I think we're seeing the true mental illness of the leftist elite and their behavior. So we're going to cover that article. We're going to cover why is the Brexit camp so obsessed with immigration, because that's all they have. And of course, this is the globalists running all this. This is how they're conquering the culture. European report card worries over euro growth. You know, will Greece do the same thing as Britain? Because if Britain does this, everybody else is going to leave. Everyone's lining up for the Brexit, but voters aren't fooled. Oh, voters aren't fooled. Should global warming deniers be prosecuted? Newsweek. I mean, this is all happening. Democratic AGs, climate change groups collude on prosecuting dissenters. Email show. That's just some of what we're covering. So, where are we politically, globally? Where is the authoritarian eugenics left, is what I call them, going? Where is the collaborator right going? Where does just free humanity go from here? To break down the current scoreboard in the epic battle for humanity and the true renaissance moving forward and the real enlightenment is Lord Christopher Monckton. It's great to have you on, Christopher. So much has happened in the last 3-4 months we haven't had you on. Please give us the state of the world, my friend.
All right, let's begin with Brexit. That's the British exit from the European dictatorship, or the European Union, as it likes to call itself. But of course, as you rightly said, it now makes getting on for 90% of Britain's laws. Our Parliament is merely a kind of rubber stamp, which has to pass directives that are handed down to us by the unelected commissars. That's the official German name for the 30 commissioners who, behind closed doors, dream up the laws that we now have to abide by. And the European Parliament itself has no power to bring forward a bill. But the breaking news, Alex, is that with 50 days to go to the referendum on June the 23rd, we're now May the 3rd, so June 23rd, 50 days to go, the opinion polls are suddenly trending very firmly in the direction of Brexit. The latest poll of polls done by the Financial Times, which is wholly in favour of Britain staying in, it's part of the anti-democratic environmentalist and political left-wing establishment. Its paper is even printed, it's printed on pink paper, which is a fairly good guide to its politics. Even the Financial Times is now reporting in its poll of polls today that there's been a sudden drop in don't knows, and nearly three quarters of the don't knows have come into the Brexit side of it, so that now it's 46% to stay in the EU and 44% to come out, and still around 11% undecided. So it looks to me as though if one does the analysis I used to do for Margaret Thatcher at 10 Downing Street, and you take the trend line of how the polls are showing over the last 6 months, what is happening is an inexorable trend towards a crossover point in probably about 2 weeks' time, at which point I would expect the opinion polls to start showing Brexit in the lead. And I think that then it'll be kind of neck and neck from then on. So it could go either way. But on present trends, we are going to leave the European Union with a vote of around 47% to leave and 43% to stay. That is my current forecast.
Amazing. You know, we've seen the communist Chinese, who have the record for mass murder, and the Pope and the Mexico and the Saudi Arabian Human Rights Commission, when they chop gay people's heads off, telling us we can't have Donald Trump and lying about him. And then we have Obama and Hillary telling people in the UK what you can do and threatening you and comparing you to Nazis if you don't stay in the EU, when, as you know, the EU was a Nazi project originally.
Well, I mean, that, in fact, is very helpful to us. Mr. Obama coming over here and trying to preach to us. This is a man whose birth certificate is a manifest forgery, who has presided over the greatest collapse in the American economy and in the American military and in the American standing around the world of any president in peace
by
or
plan.
War. If somebody like that comes over here and tells us how we should vote in a referendum which has nothing to do with the United States, then that has been enormously beneficial to us. Because
I was about to say, so where is the arrogance disconnect? I mean, this shows how disconnected these people are.
What it shows is that the British people are fed up with the global establishment, for that is what it is. It's Cameron in Obama's pocket, you know, perking out of his little front pocket. There's Cameron sitting there as Obama's poodle. We don't like seeing that in our prime ministers. We like our prime ministers to be men, as Margaret Thatcher was, the only man in her cabinet, it was to be said of her. And David Cameron is a wimp. Obama is a wimp. And he is trying to preach to us, and that has done an enormous amount of good. That has helped decide the undecideds.
Again, why are they so arrogant and disconnected?
I think it's because they've had the running for so long. The natural state of government, if you read the early Chinese philosophers, is legalist. It is totalitarian. Because governments like to interfere, people who go into politics like to interfere with our lives. But every so often, the libertarians get their say. And the extraordinary thing about this Brexit poll is that we have got that referendum in the teeth of opposition by the entire British, European, American, and global establishment, both the political and the economic establishment. Virtually every church, virtually every business, virtually every trade union, virtually every government is in favour of Britain staying in the EU because it can't bear to face the fact that we don't like totalitarianism in Britain, and we are now, as it looks at the moment, going to vote against it. And vote effectively, because if we vote no by however narrow a majority, then we will come out. And that is that. And that will be a real blow to the EU, which almost certainly immediately after the referendum, whichever way it goes, Greece is going to be driven out of the euro. It's already making secret emergency plans to reintroduce the drachma, and preferably the hard drachma, which is what I've advised it to do. But they, Greece is going to come out of the European currency, the euro, within weeks of this Brexit poll. Right. The only reason it's still in there is because the Europeans don't want Britons to realize just how fast
Very
the euro
exciting.
Is.
Lord Monckton, let's talk about where this goes from here, what will happen, what's the next shoe to drop, because I agree with you. This is total victory. We're exposing there's a foreign control. Whether we win this time or not, the victory is coming. We're all born into our country, born into this world. And there are powerful forces that don't want to compete, don't want to build things, don't want to have ideas to be successful. They don't want the free association of the Renaissance. They want to dominate. There's low-level leftists, there's big corporate combines. They all compete for grandiose plans of control. And it's our system of freedom that competes against them. Now, set beside each other, we always win. The problem is patriots, people that love humanity, aren't very good at articulating our plans because we're just too busy living. We don't want to run other people's lives. We're content. We're confident. But we have to take the field against the enemy, the dragons of our age, and believe me, they're there. What does Lord Monckton make of the populist movement in places like Austria coming to power, the new president, or Donald Trump? The system's attack is what certifies someone. A 6% trust in the AP for mainstream media. Similar numbers in the UK. I think the establishment's already collapsed. They just don't know it yet, or maybe they do. Lord Monckton, long segment coming up to get into the latest carbon taxes and their tyrannical push to regulate control of human life. But the big theme, where would you say the world is right now? Because you're starting to get to it. I mean, aren't we winning even if we lose this referendum? People now realize the EU's running us. It's making its laws. It's dictatorial. I mean, inexorably, isn't the tide turning for human freedom?
I think there's no doubt that this referendum was a great achievement just to get a referendum on this question. And that in itself was a victory. And the fact that the result is as close as it is on the opinion polls so far is also a victory because it's a very clear reminder to those who created and are driving and profiting from the European Union and various other globalizing scams of this kind that the ordinary people don't actually like them. It is the establishment and its lackeys who are voting to stay in almost unanimously. It's ordinary people who have to pay for all this who are almost unanimously voting to get out. And so this is a big moment. The fact that we even get to have our say, and okay, it could marginally go the wrong way, though I think it will marginally go the right way. But the great thing is that now that we've got the right to have our say, this is an indication that if we don't just sit back and allow the establishment to run everything, if we start taking things back into our own control, then suddenly, piece by piece, we can start running our own lives and gradually take away from governments whole swathes of what governments now do. You see, here they are, governments trying to do science and making a terrible mess of it on this global warming thing. This is breaking news, Alex. There's a very important paper out today by Professor Ray Bates of University College Dublin in Ireland. Now, he, until 3 or 4 years ago, when he and I debated the science of climate in front of the Law Society of Ireland in Galway, he was a true believer in the official position. But there were one or two things I showed him in that debate which led him to write to me afterwards and say that I had made him nervous about whether the science was all that he had thought it was, and he was going to do some checking. He spent 3 years. And now he's published his paper, which retracts his previous position and says that because they've made a fundamental mistake in the climate models over the supposed amplification of direct warming caused by what are called temperature feedbacks.
Wow.
He is the world's greatest expert on temperature feedbacks, and he now recognizes that the equation that they're using to measure this supposed amplification or describe it is the wrong equation. And therefore, wow, the model's fatally flawed. And funnily enough, his estimate of how much warming you will get if you double the CO2 in the atmosphere, this is what is known as climate sensitivity. His estimate of that figure is exactly the same as mine when I published it in the Bulletin of the Chinese Academy of Sciences, together with three very distinguished colleagues, Dr. Willie Soon from Harvard, Professor Lee Gates from Delaware.
Wasn't that their most read paper ever?
That still, to this day, is by a factor of 12 the most read paper in the 60-year archive of the Bulletin of the Chinese.
Well, I know you don't get into this for credit. You get into this to fight tyranny. But Lord Monckton, you're amazing. Your own research as a lay scientist, or the inventor, I know you're trained as well. You just keep getting even scientists to admit they're wrong. And I'm glad they're honorable. I know that article's out now, admitting that you were right. I mean, that's just
good.
Well, you're amazing.
Thing about Ray Bates, when he and I debated, the local communists turned up in the way that they usually do, and a sneering communist got up at the back after I'd finished speaking and said, you know, Professor Bates, Monckton said you were wrong about things. How can he...
Hold on, I want to hear about the commie show when we come back. This is so exciting. Lord Monckton, a force of nature. Stay with us. Ted Cruz's dad has a lot of CIA connections. That's pretty much admitted. Ted Cruz himself helped write the TPP. He's all hooked up with the top Bushes, the big Rockefeller Republicans. And now Donald Trump has come out and talked about an Infowars.com article from 3 weeks ago. I mean, we know Trump tweets out Infowars all the time. He's been on the show. He's a listener. But Trump links Cruz's father to JFK assassination. That was reported. Nobody talks about it. Trump says about mainstream media. That is now all over the news. The Inquirer is getting the coverage when Wayne Madsen wrote that for us. And he didn't say he did it. He just said, here's a photo of him. Looks like Cruz's dad. He was brought in. He was connected. He claimed he was in Cuba under Castro. He came here before. He lived in New Orleans at the time. And Cruz has other connections into that. Meanwhile, since we were mentioning it earlier, Berkshire Hathaway investors refuse to take stand on climate change, telling Warren Buffett no. Also, if Trump is nominated, the GOP must keep him out of the White House. That's George Will. I want to go over some of this authoritarianism with Lord Monckton in a moment and go to Carlos, who wants to talk about China and the USA, Nelson, Mel, Gene, Cindy, and others with Lord Monckton. Toll-free number to join us, 800-259-9231. Now I'm going to ask Lord Monckton where we can read about this prestigious professor I'm sure it's already on Science and Public Policy website, but I'm going to find out if it is. Usually as a Moncton talks about it, but having one of the top scientists, I've even read about that guy, coming out and saying this is huge. So scienceandpublicpolicy.org, if it's not there, it'll be at whatsupwiththat.com and other sites. We've got Bill Nye, the science guy, saying, yeah, go ahead and look at arresting people that question us. I mean, these people, and he gets off when he says it, are really creepy totalitarians. I mean, I don't like communists and Nazis and people, but I agree they have free speech as long as they don't call for violence. But when you start calling for my arrest for my speech, I start looking to throw you out of the country or maybe lock your butt up because you're the one saying arrest me. I mean, you're the one did it. I don't even like saying that, but man, you're just dangerous. You're just evil. So we're going to talk about that in a moment. Before I go any further, though, now is the time to be prepared with nutraceuticals to get yourself healthy, with Obamacare and the rest of it, can't count on the system, with storable foods. The elites are digging in, getting storable foods. I look at it as a tornado shelter if you live in Oklahoma or Texas or Kansas. Doesn't mean you live in fear. You got a tornado shelter. This is storable food, high quality. You can eat for 25 years. It's InfoWars Select, powered by My Patriot Supply. You can get My Patriot or InfoWars Select, exact same food. But ours is 30 to 40% under the normal price. We only can offer this twice a year. I've extended this over a week. I've got to stop it very, very soon. Take advantage and research the highest quality storable foods at the lowest prices with the best portability, the best packaging. It's amazing. InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsSelect.com takes you right to the storable foods. We also have 10% off on shortwave radios, non-GMO heirloom seeds, all of our nutraceuticals. Anything preparedness or health-related is 10% off at InfoWarsStore.com right now. The storable foods are 30 to 40%, unprecedented. People are taking advantage of it. And separately, 10% off when you sign up for auto ship on top of all that. Some of the stuff we lose money on, but that's, I'm a free market guy. That's the way to do it. Lost leaders to fund our operation. Give you high quality products at super low prices. And free shipping on any item above $50. $50 or more, InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com. Supermail Vitality was going to sell out. We found a little bit more in our storehouse than we thought we had. It'll sell out by today. Also, we've got Anthroplex back in place. We've also got the amazing Survival Shield Nascent Iodine X2, True Atomic Iodine, and so much more at InfoWarsStore.com. Take advantage of it all today. Read the five-star third-party reviews that are linked on the site. And know, whatever you're doing, you're funding pro-human, pro-liberty freedom organization that reaches now conservatively. It's 25, 26 million a few months ago. The conservative numbers, if you count YouTube and Facebook with videos watched and terrestrial radio and TV, 28 million. Quite frankly, that was a few weeks ago. We had like 14 million views now of just the stuff they shot in California in the last week on four different platforms. I mean, you add that, the metric's like 34 million now. The point is we are rampaging like liberty-fueled rhinoceroses over the enemy right now. So all over Fox News, CNN, I'm not counting that. Our footage is everywhere. No one would see the La Reconquistas hopping around saying, kill the gringos, waving Mexican flags. Nothing against Hispanics. Most of them are into that. This is what our leftist groups have funded. No one would see the Black Lives Matter and social justice warriors screaming, all whites are evil, kill them, when they're white people saying it. No one would see the literal brainwashed scum if it wasn't for our teams all over the country and the world now. We're hiring more reporters, more camera crews. I'm all in. I have not been paid. I'm not bragging, but I'm not money-based here. I have not been paid this year yet. Doesn't matter. I got family ranch since 1829, and I don't need money, okay? I'm not rich, but I'm taken care of. I'm taking everything and putting it in right now. All went in the sales, everything committed. History is being affected. The battle space is being affected. This is an epic time. Going back to Lord Moncton. Lord Moncton, recap this big professor coming out that you debated famously and saying you're right at scienceandpublicpolicy.org. Where do we read about it? What's the latest attacks on our energy system? Then I want to take some phone calls.
Right now, so far, because this paper is so new, it hasn't been written about anywhere. I've got an advanced copy of it.
And oh, this
so
is breaking. This is wow, thank you.
Breaking news. This is the first time anyone's heard about it. And it's a very exciting paper by Professor Ray Bates. And as I was just saying before the break, when he and I debated this, and up gets one of the local Irish communists and says, oh, Professor Bates, he says you're wrong, but he's not a scientist and you are, so therefore he must be wrong. Ray Bates went up to the microphone. This is unprecedented in my experience. It shows the quality of the man. And he said, look,
it must be plain to you, as it is to me, that Lord Monckton is knowledgeable about this subject, and he and his arguments should be treated fairly and with respect. Now, that's very unusual for anyone on the other side of the debate to say a thing like that. And that
they usually say arrest you.
Yes.
They usually say arrest you.
That's right, and we'll come on to that in a moment. But I just want to finish off on Ray Bates, because this is the world expert on temperature feedbacks. Now, that's these amplifying mechanisms which are imagined by the computer models and the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change and all the other spooky people. And they try to say this multiplies by three the small direct warming from carbon dioxide. Now, Professor Bates has now, having watched where my doubts were about the feedback equation, he has now confirmed that the feedbacks don't work in the way that all the climate models say they do. And that if you correct for that huge error, then you're looking not at 3 or 4 Celsius degrees of warming per doubling of CO2 concentration, you're looking at the 1 Celsius of warming, which is what we published in the Chinese Science Bulletin 18 months ago. And he's now agreeing with that figure and saying, yes, that is the correct figure. We don't have a climate problem anymore. And this is an extraordinary piece of news, because this was one of the, I won't say an arch enemy, because this is too honorable a man, too diligent a scientist to be an enemy of anyone. He just loves his science. But the fact that he has come out and said, I can no longer sit and pretend for the sake of getting on well with my mates. Fortunately, he's now retired, so he's rather more free to speak out than he would have been if he was still working. As you know, in academia now, if you take the wrong side in this debate, you are punished most severely by the hard left and the Marxists and the academic institutions. So he is now retired, so they can't do that to him. But nevertheless, this is an enormously significant...
Well, it takes an amazing person when they've been proven wrong to admit it.
Well, I mean, it's extraordinary that he should come out and change his mind on this, having done 3 years of very detailed work, and it took nearly a year to get this paper passed.
But he now realizes they were giving him false equations.
Yeah, the central equation that is used to calculate how much warming we're going to get contains a very large error, and that's what the significance of Ray Bates's paper is. It demonstrates just how large that error is. It multiplies the actual warming by three.
Well, he's a very classy scientist. I want to play Bill Nye, because as their science crumbles, as they're proven to be fraud, as even mainstream news admits, higher CO2 is good for plants, good for humans, they're openly saying, let's start locking people up. This is really a drumbeat. Attorney General's doing it in the U.S. Very creepy.
I can tell you why they're doing it. They're doing it because they know that we, the fraud investigation group of the International Committee on Geoethics, which is a new ethical grouping which was founded last year by Professor Niklas Myhrner of Sweden, who's the world's greatest expert on sea level. He got so fed up with the dishonesty in science that he and several distinguished colleagues got together and founded an international committee, and they have also established as part of that committee a fraud investigation group which I run. And one of the things we are about to do is to start prosecuting people on the other side who have actually committed certain specific...
And by the way, you got Al Gore's film exposed. They can still show it. They just had to admit all the lies in it. So you've had a lot of success already.
That's right. We did this in 2007 in the High Court in London when we took Al Gore's movie to court. We took the government to court for wanting to give, at $20 a pop, copies of this ghastly sci-fi comedy horror movie to every school in England. And they were only allowed to do it if they also circulated 77 pages of corrective guidance that we made put in. So that was a huge victory for us. And now we're going after them, not in the civil courts, but we're going after them in the criminal courts.
You promised to do that. That's very exciting. I want to get to that now, but let's show the empire striking back, the communist globalist empire. Let's play Bill Nye when Mark Moreno, another great champion, only second to you, went out and asked him, quote, you're not really going to call for our arrest. And this is what Bill Nye, with sickening pleasure, starts licking his lips almost, talking about arresting people. And he says, Enron, when Enron with Al Gore came up with the scam. So the richness of this is just too good. Here it is.
We interviewed Robert F. Kennedy Jr., the environmentalist, here at the People's Climate March in 2014, mm-hmm. September. He said that the climate deniers, his word, and energy CEOs belong at The Hague with three square meals and a cot with all the other war criminals. What is your thought on that? Do you think some of the rhetoric on your side, as I'm sure both sides, but some of the rhetoric on your side gets too carried away? I mean, you don't. What's your thought on jailing skeptics as war criminals?
We'll see what happens. Was it appropriate to jail the guys from Enron?
Interesting.
Okay, right. So we'll see what happens. If was it appropriate to jail people from the cigarette industry who insisted that this addictive product was not addictive and so on? And you think about, in these cases, for me as a taxpayer and voter, the introduction of this extreme doubt, where you go with extreme doubt about climate change, is affecting my quality of life as a public citizen. So I can see where people are very concerned about this and are pursuing criminal investigations as well as engaging in discussions like this.
All right, we're going to go back to Lord Monckton in a moment, but talk about stealing free speech. Here is the fake conservative, George Will, in this weekend's edition of the Washington Post. If Trump is nominated, the GOP must keep him out of the White House. And then he goes on to say, quote, a convention's sovereign duty, saying the party members are sovereign, is to choose a plausible nominee who has a reasonable chance to win. So forget the voters, that's ceremonial, not to passively affirm the will of a mere plurality of voters recorded episodically in a protracted process. Now, why I get to that is Bill Nye saying, yeah, we should look at arresting people. And Lord Monckton's always chief among them. That's all over the news. And then George Will saying, we never have elections. Who says you ever voted? Again, there is such an authoritarianism showing itself. Don't they get it's already backfiring, Lord Monckton?
They don't. You see, the reason why there's all this stuff from Bill Nye and others about prosecuting us is that they know they wouldn't stand a chance if they tried to prosecute us, because we would then be able to produce all the evidence in court that they try to conceal from the people in the mainstream media. That's what happened in the Al Gore case in London.
Hoisted on their own spear.
I saw the enormous, overwhelming, crushing weight of evidence. I wrote the 80 pages of scientific testimony, which won the case. And once the judge saw that, the other side simply collapsed and caved in and said, okay, it's a fair cop. The film shouldn't be shown unless people are warned that it's inaccurate. And this was an extraordinary victory. But what we are now doing is we are not just waving our hands around and saying we're going to prosecute everybody. We're saying there are a few people who are saying specific things which constitute scientific fraud. They're making money and causing us losses as taxpayers by deliberately getting the science wrong and misrepresenting often the results.
That's
of their
key. They're getting taxpayer money and fear-mongering their frauds.
And what we are going to do is to go to the courts with specific individual cases. We don't go around waving our arms like windmills and saying everyone who believes global warming is a problem ought to be locked up, which is the way they're doing it to us. We're saying there are a few people who have acted in a definite...
Well, sure, what about saying hide the decline and telling other universities to hide the decline to get funding? That's clear fraud on the public, in my view.
I think that's right, and I think the professor who went in for that ought to have been arrested and put on trial. He wasn't. It's not something for us to do now. We've got much more recent cases where there has been deliberate misrepresentation by so-called scientists of their scientific results for the sake of pushing a purely political agenda, which is very much to the cost of the ordinary taxpayer and which will show no benefit whatsoever to
Lord
the
Lord Monckton, let me interrupt. You're making great points, but I've got to interrupt. I've got to interrupt. You're joining us over there in the U.K., I want to go to break, come back, and do a few phone calls. Maybe 5 minutes over the next hour, if you got to go, understand. I want to take a few calls. Great questions from callers there. Overall, how is the fight going? I said I think we're turning the tide, but they're authoritarian and don't care. I mean, is it fair to say, though, we're having some big victories?
I think we are now winning on far more fronts than the establishment would like to admit. The governing class has had it its own way for quite some time now, but the EU... Brexit referendum, that the fact that it's as close as it is has come as a terrible shock to those who told us that everyone was in favour of the European Union. They now know that that is not the case. Likewise, the fact that the extremists in the climate debate are demanding in a vague sort of way that everyone who speaks out and says that climate isn't a problem or global warming isn't a problem should be arrested, the fact that they are forced into that kind of extremism
shows they're authoritarian.
Shows they know they've lost. And I think what is happening here is that on the EU, on the climate, and of course the two are related because the totalitarians in the EU are at one with the totalitarians in the climate, they're at one with the totalitarians in the Muslim movement. Totalitarians worldwide are standing together in a way which has never been seen before.
I agree. Hasn't the left miscalculated, allying itself not just with Islam, but the most nasty forms of it?
Certainly, Jeremy Corbyn in this country now faces, he's the leader of the Labour Party, he's a communist. He has faced terrific criticism in the last week because his party has been found not only to be anti-Semite, but he himself has shared a platform with some of the nastiest terrorist groups that Islam has to offer, and he's done it over and over and over again for years and continues to do it. And finally, the voters are beginning to wake up, and the Labour Party is now looking like a laughing stock because this was the party that said that we shouldn't be racialist and we shouldn't do anything with terrorists. And now here we have its leader totally in the pocket of some of the nastiest...
An incredible miscalculation. Stay there, Lord Monk. I'm going to come back and take phone calls. Scienceandpublicpolicy.org. I tell you, this guy is on the march. So are we. Stay with us. Your calls are straight ahead. By the way, coming up tonight, 7 o'clock Central, we're going to have live coverage of the big primaries coming up tonight that are so incredibly important. Our great crew, everybody from Darren McGreen to Rob News, Jakari Jackson, to David Knight and others, Leanne McAdoo's on vacation, well-deserved, are going to be covering it this evening. I'll be popping in live as well. InfoWarsNews.com, InfoWars.com/show to find stations and affiliates and all the other things that are happening. I want to go to your phone calls in this short segment, one other than Lord Monkton's leaving us. And then we have hosting the fourth hour, Paul Joseph Watson from the UK as well, from London. Very popular host. Paul, in and of his own self now, is a huge star for Liberty, just exploding everywhere. I made him get on air. He's been working for me 16 years, but 5 years ago I said, I'm cutting your pay if you don't go on air. And that guy, I don't want to do it. And I said, you're going on air. He's smarter than I am. That guy is just huge now. So exciting. That's why if you're a Liberty lover, get on the air. Do a YouTube channel. I'm telling you, folks, build it. They will come. This is the animating contest. But Lord Monkton, briefly, I want to go to these calls from a bunch of different callers, Ron and Gene and HB and Mel and Nelson. What do you think of Donald Trump? No matter who he really is, the fact that he's populist, they're demonizing him, that only makes him more popular. That shows me the system is out of gas.
Well, let me say one thing, which is I have met Ted Cruz and I like him. And I think he would probably be more experienced at running the presidency than Donald Trump would be. However, when you see people like George Will going around and saying, well, the mere people and their vote, the mere plurality, hello, a pluribus unum is on your currency. Plurality, which means the most people who vote, that's what happens. That's what's Amen. Called democracy. It's what your republic is supposed to be all about. And if George Will, whom I normally quite admire, has lost the plot on that, he's lost the plot on everything. And I think that looking at this, one of the most unpopular things about Donald Trump is that he has been so successful because, like you, Alex, he has said boo to the establishment. He's broken every political rule in the book, and every time he breaks one, up he goes in the polls. And I must say, although I don't think he's the best candidate for president, I think he would be fairly disastrous in the White House because I don't think he would know how to run things. I do think that if he is chosen fair and square, then he should be in the White House.
That's sure, the exactly. Works. I've had my own issues. It's the arrogance of saying you can't have him that's backfiring. It's almost like you're doing it on purpose, but I don't want to get that conspiratorial.
Well, I think it sometimes does look as though they're doing it on purpose to help him out, because George Will really ought to know better than to waffle on about a mere plurality in a protracted process. Of course it's a protracted process because everybody has to get their chance to vote. That takes time.
Arrogance.
The fact is that if you are, as you and I are, Alex, believers that there is a wisdom in crowds, that democracy is therefore important because everybody, however little, however unimportant the establishment thinks they are, Everybody has the same pencil, the same cross they can put on that ballot paper,
yeah,
and that vote counts just as much as anybody else's. That's the way democracy works, and you and I, Alex, keep a firm grasp on that. And I think to do him credit, so does Donald Trump, and I'm not sure that George Will does. I think he's lost the plot this time.
I hear you. Real quick question, one question in this segment, a few more in the next. HB in FEMA Region 4, whatever former state that is, you want to talk to Lord Monckton about the new film. Go ahead, HB.
My wife and I went to see it last night, and all they focused on was CO2. They never brought geoengineering into it. They didn't get Dane Wigington in there, and we were just kind of disappointed in it.
Yeah, I'm worried about the globalists using geoengineering to cause bad weather and bring in tyranny. Lord Monckton, overall, though, you're in that film. What do you think? They're trying to censor it.
Yes, I mean, I did take part in the film. I also went to the premiere in Paris, which was a great event. I think it's a great film. Because the fact is that the main thrust of the battle that we still have to fight is to convince as many people as possible.
Sure, disprove the science. Sorry to cut you off. Scienceandpublicpolicy.org. Stay there, sir. We're back in 60 seconds. 70 seconds. Lord Monckton, straight ahead. I'll be able to finish that question and take more. I was talking about this broadcast. Our guests, our listeners, our reporters are as real as it gets. I'm very honored and humbled to be here. In the last 5 minutes, we have Lord Monckton. And Paul Wadsden comes in for the fourth hour, a fresh horse. A big brain in the fight for liberty. Straight ahead. I want to take phone calls with Lord Monckton, scienceandpublicpolicy.org. And he's right. The science is where it's all at. That's where you win this thing or lose it. And they are scared right now. Ron, go ahead, Lord Monckton. Finish your point. Then we're going to Ron in Washington. Go ahead.
The point I was making is a sound one, that there's a lot of nonsense being talked about the need to do geoengineering. The fact is, all such schemes are far more dangerous than global warming would ever be. They're also far more expensive.
Aren't they just boondoggles?
And they probably wouldn't work either.
Aren't they just boondoggles where these guys get billions to play savior of the earth?
That is exactly what it's all about. And the time for these frauds to continue is now drawing to a close as our fraud investigation team starts getting its teeth into the worst of these fraudsters and bringing them actually into the courts one by one. That's the way to deal with criminality in the scientific sphere. These scientists have got to understand they are no longer above the law just because they wear white coats with leaky biros.
By the way, I was having you on 10 years ago and you weren't this positive. I mean, we're not cheerleading here. And we're still in deep trouble, but, I mean, there's some major success happening.
We are winning now. The movement, as far as the science is concerned, the climate official line has collapsed. There's no longer any way to shore it up. The growing discrepancy between what they said would happen and the far lesser rate of warming that has happened, this is something they can no longer deny.
Well, they want to stand in the way of human progress, control all of our energy and play God like communists handing out sausages and bread in Moscow in 1970. I mean, it's just so exciting to see them in trouble. And nobody deserves more credit than you, Lord Monckton. I know you don't want it, but here's the Lord Monckton, folks. Let's all toast to him right now, metaphysically, to the truth and standing up and being proven right in the end. A true example for us all, Lord Christopher Monckton, scienceandpublicpolicy.org. I got loaded phone lines. We only got time for one more before Paul Wadsden. Ron in Washington State, you're on the air with Lord Monckton. Go ahead.
Hello, Ron. Two quick points. One, the problem isn't CO2 excess. It's O2 minimalized. There's too little oxygen in the world right now. That's point one. Point two, why don't you, in the same time you cause these individuals to stand justice for fraud, RICO them at the same time? Because of their profits.
Is, of course, a very good option, and we are looking at that because we get triple damages if the court awards damages. So that's certainly a thing that we are looking at.
Sure, RICO's the standard deal, but I mean, don't we need though more carbon, more oxygen, more carbon? I mean, aren't we in a starved level right now?
Yes, we are. We need more carbon dioxide. And to answer the first questioner's point, which is about, is there too little oxygen? When Joseph Priestley first discovered oxygen, he was able to measure its content in the atmosphere quite accurately 200 or 300 years ago at 20.67%. And if you were to measure it today, it is still 20.67%. So don't worry, the oxygen isn't running out.
Oh, good.
There's plenty of plants and trees, the CO2 is fertilizing them, and they are therefore producing oxygen very happily, and so we can all breathe safely at night.
But it is an incredible trace gas we live off of. I mean, thank God for it.
Well, of course, oxygen isn't a trace gas. CO2 is a trace gas, and that is...
It just sounds really low, though, compared to...
Life on Earth, all animal life on Earth and all plant life on Earth absolutely depends on CO2, and the idea of demonizing it is one of the left's stupidest mistakes.
Look at the left symbol. The peace symbol is a symbol of death.
On this, as on everything, is simply wrong, scientifically speaking and objectively speaking. It's simply wrong. Most of them know it now, and they're all trying to work out their escape route. For some of them, there will be no escape
route. Great job, Lord Monckton. Congratulations. We salute you. Thank you, Lord Monckton.
God bless.
Paul Watson's coming out of the bullpen into the gates right now.
We're live. It's the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show with me, your host, Paul Joseph Watson. At the bottom of the hour, we're going to be talking to Richard Reeves specifically about that amazing incident yesterday in Indiana where Ted Cruz was confronted by a heckler, the media are calling him, a Trump protester. Ted Cruz basically got owned. Of course, he's completely desperate now. If he fails in Indiana to take enough delegates off Trump, which it looks like he will indeed fail to do, then he's basically finished. They're talking about rumors of him suspending his campaign later this week. So could this confrontation between Ted Cruz and this protester in Indiana have been a setup, a provocation, a planned event, not something that just naturally occurred from the very beginning? We're going to talk to Richard Reeves because he's been around, in and around these primaries. He's tried to get access to Ted Cruz, and he basically says it's the hardest thing imaginable. And yet somehow we get this spontaneous confrontation between Cruz and this pro-Trump, anti-Cruz protester. Was Ted Cruz trying to incite some act of violence or stage some kind of PR event when he partook in this confrontation? We're going to talk to Richard Reeves about that later because, again, it illustrates the desperation that Cruz is now betraying as he heads into Indiana with the polls firmly against him. So we're going to get to that in the bottom of the hour, but I want to start off with this because the Fat Pride movement and the unholy alliance between the Fat Pride movement and third wave feminism is something that I've delved into on many occasions in the past. And in fact, I've got a video coming out later today about this issue. Some of you will remember last year there was a supplier of protein products called Protein World here in the United Kingdom. They came out with an ad, which was basically a massive poster campaign slapped across subways, billboards across the country. And the ad said, "Are you beach body ready?" behind a picture of a thin, shapely woman. Again, God forbid you would want to show somebody who was thin, fertile and attractive in a bod, in an ad which is about an aspirational goal of achieving a beach body. God forbid you would want to do that as a company that sells protein products to help people try and achieve this level of fitness. Of course, what happened was the poster campaign was completely defaced. Fat, militant feminists spewed in outrage all over the shop. They basically carried out bomb threats against Protein World. That happened. And of course, the media jumped right in. And again, it became about this issue of making fat pride and body positivity, and indeed, in some cases, obesity, a social justice cause, rather than what it is in reality, which is a chronic health problem, which costs the National Health Service in the UK £16 billion, every single year. More than smoking, more than alcohol. And yet, again, it's been turned, with the aid of the leftist media narrative, into a massive social justice cause. So we're going to get into that, because basically the Fat Pride movement, as I've illustrated before, is incredibly harmful to women, which is why this bizarre alliance with feminism, as we've seen, makes no sense unless you understand that third wave feminism has nothing whatsoever to do with helping women. It has everything to do with allowing these permanently offended, constantly triggered, militant fat feminists feel better about themselves to the detriment of everybody else, to the detriment of women furthering their own careers by appearing in ads such as the Protein World Beachbody ad, by, you know, being grid girls, being page three girls, women actually having the choice, whether you agree with it or not morally, to do what they want with their own body. You would think that would be an ideal supported by feminists, but in every single case, it's not. Again, they tried to ban the Athena tennis girl poster last year. Every single example where a woman chooses to use her good looks, her body, to get ahead in life, they clamp down on it at every single turn. And we're seeing that again with these ads, the Beachbody ad, which we saw last year, and similar ones in future, because the Business Insider is reporting the UK's ad regulator is cracking down on adverts that stereotype women. The UK's advertising watchdog is launching a formal investigation into, quote, gender stereotyping in advertising. Now, this is the Advertising Standards Authority. This is the official body that regulates advertising and has the power to ban certain imagery in advertising. So now they're talking about basically banning thin, attractive women to please permanently offended fat, militant feminists off the back of last year's Protein World controversy. Now, listen to what the head of this agency, Guy Parker, said. He said that the agency plans to ban ads that, quote, cause offence. So if any small number of organised militant fringe extremists, which is what the Fat Pride movement is, decides that they're offended by something, they will complain and that ad will be banned. Again, this is another example of them seizing power simply off the platform of being offended or claiming to be offended. But this is being done in the name of, quote, equality. Again, Parker said the ban was a result of the increasing political and public debate on equality issues. Yet, what will this new round of regulation address? Well, according to him, it will address, quote, the objectification and sexualization of women in ads. Not of men and women, just of women. So, of course, it's going to be completely fine for Cristiano Ronaldo to parade around in his tight underwear for Armani. But God forbid you would want to show an attractive thin model on the front of a Beachbody ad. That will be banned to appease militant, fat, permanently outraged feminists. This is what's happening in the UK. Again, just one small example of how they gain control of media simply by being offended. And again, this is about the Fat Pride movement proving what it is, which is a detriment to women. This is all based around the fact that feminists are basically inflicting their self-loathing on other women. The stereotype is generally true. I don't know if you've noticed, but most of them aren't too hot. They tend to be social and sexual failures with bizarre multicolored hair, not too attractive, and in many cases, grossly overweight. We've all seen the legend of Trigglypuff, and now that's percolating down into them actually trying to ban the use of pretty women in adverts. And that could be dismissed as some fringe radical belief, you know, Tumblr, Twitter feminists screeching once again, why don't you just ignore them? They have no power. Well, this is yet another example. They have power. They're taking over certain sectors of the media when we know that they're taking over certain sectors of university campuses with the complete myth, BS, college rape culture that they've invented, which now at the University of Massachusetts, which is where last week's the triggering event happened, where the Trigglypuff meltdown occurred. Now I'm getting messages from students at that university who say that male students who basically just go to a party, just show up to a party and merely look at a woman in a way that's not appreciated, you know, gaze rape, they call it. In some cases, those female students, again, hopped up on this militant feminism, are reporting them for sexual assault simply for looking at them. That's what some of the, in this case, a female student at the University of Massachusetts told me just a few days ago in the aftermath of this triggering event, where now the social justice warriors who got denounced, who got called out by Steven Crowder, by Milo Yiannopoulos, by Christina Hoff Sommers, are now complaining, claiming that their safe spaces were violated and actually talking about suing people for having a different opinion. So they're crushing free speech or attempting to at the university level. They're imposing censorship at the media level in terms of advertising.
And this is just the latest round of that. So again, I've got a big video on that coming out later, proving once again that feminism is harmful to women, not only in pushing body positivity and saying that obese people should have just embrace it, even though it's linked with all manner of horrible life-shortening diseases, but now they're basically going to put good-looking, attractive women who have worked hard out of work simply because they're triggered by their appearance. Because again, in most cases, these people aren't too hot. They don't take responsibility for their own horrible lifestyle choices. So instead of them having to own up to that and get on a exercise bike or go running in the park, no, it's society that has to cater for it. It's airlines that have to widen seats to accommodate obese people, not obese people having to lose weight. And if you dare suggest that losing weight might be a good idea, well, maybe that's a hate crime. Maybe you're going to get sued for having that opinion, and your ads are going to get banned and boycotted, as we saw with Protein World. What actually happened is that Protein World refused to apologize, which most people don't get, that that is the ultimate and only way of defeating these social justice warriors. Never back down, never cave in. They refused to do so. They made about £1 million more than they would have expected simply because of all the free publicity. And then they launched the exact same huge billboard campaign in New York City. So again, an example to anyone else who is the victim of this outrage culture: never back down, never apologize. But in the case of the ASA, the UK Advertising Standards Authority, they have caved in to fat militant feminists. And in their own words, they're talking about censoring the objectification of women, which, as you saw with the Protein World example, is basically thin, attractive women. But it's not going to apply for men, proving again that it has nothing to do with equality. We'll be back after this break on the fourth hour overdrive of The Alex Jones Show. Breaking news at Infowars.com. We'll be back. We're back on the fourth hour overdrive of The Alex Jones Show. We've got Richard Reeves coming up in the next segment to talk about that confrontation between Ted Cruz and the pro-Trump protester in Indiana. Was it staged? Was it a setup? Was it an attempt on behalf of the Cruz campaign to provoke these Trump protesters and to create some kind of incident which they could then use to again peddle this media narrative that Trump supporters are violent? When, of course, in every single example that we've documented over and over again, it's the leftist Bernie Sanders supporters who are spitting in people's faces, punching them in the face, kicking them on the ground, defacing vehicles, all manner of civil unrest and riotous behavior that we've seen over the past couple of months. Again, the media continues to blame it on Donald Trump. Was that confrontation an attempt to contrive some kind of similar incident? Richard Reeves is going to give us the inside take on that because he's been around the Ted Cruz campaign, so that's coming up in the next segment. But I wanted to flash back to this quote, and we've got a video clip coming up in a second. This is Karl Rove from 2004. And Alex has included this quote in his documentary films before. Quote, "We're an empire now. And when we act, we create our own reality. And while you're studying that reality, judiciously as you will, we'll act again, creating other new realities which you can study too. And that's how things will sort out. We are history's actors. And you, all of you, will be left to just study what we do." So that was Karl Rove back in 2004, sounding pretty confident on the notion that he and the establishment, the elite in general, were able to craft reality completely outside of the notion of any objective reality. And that is particularly relevant when it comes to the Donald Trump campaign, given what Karl Rove said about Donald Trump as recently as July last year. Let's go to that clip.
I do think there are sort of three tiers of candidates. There are three candidates who, in reverse alphabetical order, Walker, Rubio, Bush, or alphabetical order, Bush, Rubio, Walker, or inside out order, Rubio, Walker, Bush, or Rubio, Bush, Walker. That's the top tier. we're likely to see the nominee come out of that group. We have a second tier, which includes people like Ted Cruz and Governor Perry and Ben Carson and maybe a couple of others, and one or two, you know, one or Mike Huckabee, Rick Santorum, maybe one of those gets into the top tier. But right now they're in the second tier. And then we've got sort of the third tier, which are people who really are unlikely to break through. They're good people, some of them, but they're unlikely to break through. Or in the case of Donald Trump, they're complete idiots.
That was Karl Rove back in July last year saying basically that Donald Trump had no chance whatsoever. He was a third tier candidate, and that Rubio, Walker and Bush would be the top tier candidates, all of whom, of course, have dropped out, their campaigns ending in complete failure. Well, it appears that Karl Rove is not so good at creating reality anymore, and in fact, he has turned out to be the complete idiot, because this is out of Politico.com. Poll, Trump up to 56% nationally. Now, of course, yesterday we had Rasmussen come out and say that Trump was ahead of Hillary Clinton in a hypothetical head-to-head for the first time, among some estimates. Of course, we had the narrative that it's impossible for Trump to beat Hillary. The only candidates that could beat Hillary were Kasich and Cruz. Now that's being overturned. So Politico reports Donald Trump reached a new high among Republicans in a national NBC News poll released Tuesday. The real estate mogul has 56% support, more than doubling his advantage over Ted Cruz, who sits at 22%. Kasich rounds out the survey with 14% support, an additional 7% remain undecided. And of course, in that poll yesterday, Rasmussen, you had 89% of Republicans saying basically that they were comfortable with Donald Trump being the candidate. There's very little enthusiasm amongst Republican voters for this brokered convention. We have another poll. This is Gateway Pundit. Trump jumps to 34-point lead in California after violent leftists and Mexicans riot outside Trump rally. So again, yet another poll in which Donald Trump is leaping ahead, confounding claims that he's a complete loser made by Karl Rove back in 2004, who seems unable or incapable of crafting that reality which he bragged about so much back 12 years ago. We're going to be back after the break with Richard Reeves talking about that confrontation between Cruz and the pro-Trump protesters. This is the Alex Jones Show Live. Don't go away. You're back on the fourth hour overdrive of the Alex Jones Show. Now, of course, yesterday we saw this amazing confrontation between Ted Cruz and a pro-Trump protester, which the media is calling a heckler, in Indiana. Basically, Cruz went up to him and tried to stage some kind of incident. We're going to get into some speculation on what might have happened behind that here with Richard Reeves in a moment. But basically, Cruz is trying to ask the Trump protester, and we played the video earlier in the show, you know, why he supports Donald Trump. And of course, lying Ted being lying Ted told a bunch of lies once again. Now, of course, Cruz told the protester, quote, he's not going to build the wall and he's not going to deport anyone. And he claimed that this is what Trump, in a secret interview, told the New York Times editorial board. Of course, there's no evidence that actually happened. In fact, the New York Times itself said, quote, it's not as if we are sitting on a news story here or holding something back from publication. So the New York Times itself basically intimated that Trump never said that, and yet Cruz states it as an assertion of fact. He's not going to build the wall. He's not going to deport anyone. That's what Cruz said that Trump told the New York Times. It never happened. Also, and we played the video again earlier, Cruz said that Trump said he'd cut a deal with Chuck Schumer to, quote, take away your Second Amendment. Of course, again, another complete bold-faced lie. What Trump actually said was that he could cut a deal with Schumer in a general sense. The issue of the Second Amendment, the issue of gun control, never came up. So even in trying to imply that Donald Trump was a liar in that confrontation, Ted Cruz told two more flagrant lies. Again, it completely backfired. At the end of the confrontation, Ted Cruz is doing all these dramatic pauses. You know, he's not actually trying to talk to people in a normal conversation. He's acting like he's giving a speech at the National Press Club or CPAC. So he keeps pausing between saying his words, which gives the protesters the chance to jump in. And Ted Cruz basically says, what is the real question? And they respond, are you from Canada? And everybody just laughs out loud again, completely backfired. Yet it appears that this could have been a last ditch desperate measure by Ted Cruz to stage some kind of incident. Now we've got up on Infowars.com, tiny crowd greets Cruz in Indiana. Cruz can't even reach capacity of small venues. Go and look at these pictures and then compare them to the Donald Trump rallies. He's basically finished. We've got DC Whispers reporting Cruz preparing to suspend campaign this week. Again, his sources, this is a Washington insider, suggesting that if he performs poorly in Indiana, which the polls suggest he will, Cruz could suspend his campaign. He could give up on the idea of a brokered convention altogether. So this is how desperate the Cruz campaign is going into Indiana, which is interesting that it coincides with this confrontation, which seemingly came out of nowhere. Now, we've got Richard Reeves on the line. He, of course, has been reporting for InfoWars at these primary events. He's noted how almost nigh on impossible it is to get access to Ted Cruz, and yet suddenly, spontaneously, Cruz is having a conversation with, in some cases, these irate pro-Trump protesters. So, Richard, welcome to the show.
Hey, Paul, thanks for bringing me in real quick on the last minute. Yes, I just had to report this today. It's election day in Indiana, okay, so it's super important Richard. To get this out.
We'll get to Richard in a second, but again, you go up on Infowars.com. Tiny crowds greet Cruz in Indiana.
What happened?
Ted Cruz is only attracting tiny crowds of people to his speeches in Indiana, indicating his campaign is facing complete collapse. And there's a bunch of tweets here with the pictures. Basically, he can't even fill a quarter of a small auditorium. You compare that to the size of the Trump crowds, standing room only. You know, Ted Cruz is completely finished. He's getting desperate, which is interesting that it coincides with this confrontation, which seems to have been staged. Let's talk to Richard Reeves about it. Richard, you've been on the campaign trail there at the primaries. You've tried to access the Cruz inner circle. You've noted how difficult it is, and yet suddenly we have this spontaneous confrontation. Seems a little contrived, don't you think?
Absolutely, 100% contrived. Paul, I saw that last night on Fox, and it's like, whoa, that doesn't happen that way. And what it is basically, you know, I've been on the campaign trail starting back in December. I confronted Ted Cruz to invite him on the Alex Jones Show numerous times, live and in person, and through surrogates. But to get to the live and in person, basically your best opportunity normally to Ted Cruz is you have to wait for a chance at the rope line. You know, his surrogates really won't help you necessarily unless you're a big ABC, NBC affiliate, something like that. They basically just, oh, you give me your email and phone number and that's it. So basically you got to wait for the rope line. And Matt Weber right there in our production studio can attest to this. He was my cameraman on some of these trips that we made to see Ted Cruz. So anyway, so bottom line is, even if you go, let's say, to the back of a venue, it could be a small venue, it could be a small civic center or something like that. Well, basically, the Secret Service and or whoever the security team that Ted Cruz was using, I don't know for sure if it was Secret Service, it appeared to be to me, but anyway, they would actually make sure that the back entrance area, the entrance area where Ted Cruz would come in, would be totally secured. You couldn't be back there because I tried to go back there in the back to be able to have a minute or two conversation, a question and back and forth with him. No way, Jose, was that going to happen. So when I saw that clip yesterday, I thought, wow, that is totally not spontaneous, because what I'm sure he did is he looked around at some venue. I wish we could get all 100% of the details, but he clearly looked around and found some Trump supporters, and he didn't go to the mainstream guys. He went to guys that had been NWO, you know, soft-killed heavily. I myself am heavily soft-killed. To what degree, I don't know, but all of us are soft-killed to some degree. So he selected some intimidating-looking Trump supporters that have been, you know, had a little extra soft-kill done to him. So he clearly, in my view, was trying to provoke a punch to be thrown. I have no doubt about that. And by the way, Glenn Beck was with him in that incident because I was monitoring the enemy transmission today by Glenn Beck, and he says, oh, yeah, Ted Cruz walked across the street to confront these Trump supporters. So there's corroboration right now. These Trump supporters didn't necessarily seek Ted Cruz out. He was cherry-picking and finding. It's just like we see with mainstream left-stream media, where there could be a protest about some super legitimate, valid issue, but who do the mainstream guys look to find to be the you know, the proponents or the spokespersons for that cause? They'll find somebody that, you know, not necessarily mainstream America can identify with.
So it looks like it was a deliberate decision by the Cruz campaign to go and confront these protesters. Like you said, they picked some of the less intelligent, the more aggressive ones. They kind of calmed down after Cruz was talking to them for a couple of minutes. And yet still, Cruz ended up getting owned because he tried to impugn Donald Trump by grilling these individuals on why they support Donald Trump. But in the process, he only exposed himself to be a liar because he said that Trump told the New York Times editorial board in this secret interview that's so explosive, the New York Times says there's basically nothing to it and they're not even going to release it, that Trump said, quote, he's not going to build the wall, he's not going to deport anyone. There's no evidence that Trump ever said that. So even in the act of trying to impugn Trump as a liar, Ted Cruz only proves himself to be a massive liar. It only backfired, didn't it?
Yes, it backfired. And I'll tell you what, that's probably going to backfire on him, but, you know, he tried it. That's what's worrisome, is that we got to watch out for these staged false flag. You know, the New World Order, the powers that be, are just chomping at the bit for Trump supporters to appear violent in any manner. You know, it's just like in the upcoming general election, whenever we see Trump get this nomination, they're probably going to replay that one guy from North Carolina, that older gentleman, the 70-plus-year-old that took a swipe at the Black Lives Matter kid, and they're probably going to play that. We're going to probably see that a million times. It'll probably be bigger than, you know, you name it, the shot across the world, the punch across the world, whatever punch, you know, that across the world. So, yeah, he got caught in more lies. He got caught in that, and I tell you, Paul, one thing that we noticed, and we reported on it last Tuesday, was in that five-state, the Acela primary, where you had Connecticut, Rhode Island, Pennsylvania, Maryland, Delaware, we noticed Ted Cruz had dropped down into, you know, barely over 10%, 10, 11, 12%, I think his highest state. I think he got 19, 20% in his highest state out of the five last week. So really, a big key turning point was, and we called it last Tuesday by pointing out those numbers, is when he teamed up with Kasich to try to play Indiana in his favor, to get people not to vote for Kasich in Indiana and come over and vote for him, and also the states of Oregon that they're playing games with, Oregon and New Mexico. So that was a key point when we saw Trump zoom up to that 60% level in those five states. It was expected we'd see 50 or 60% in New York, but those Acela states, the five states that came up last Tuesday, that was really big, and I think that showed the beginning of the end to Ted Cruz. And so now we've seen him make more and more mistakes. And I'll tell you what, with today being such a pivotal day with Indiana, we just absolutely had to get this story out. Ted Cruz knew that this would be on mainstream press. And look, even though there was no physical altercation, he still succeeded on getting that coverage. Well, how much of that type of coverage have you seen him talking with Trump supporters before? You know, it's right now on the eve of Indiana. You see it finally.
No, he just seems to be lurching from one disaster to another. Do you think that if he performs poorly in Indiana, that basically he's gonna fold, or is he gonna drag it on to a brokered convention?
Well, I'm gonna make a video on this later and give a full update on that. But basically, I think if Ted Cruz gets whipped tonight at the polls, which watch out for black box voting, we know about that. We'll have to watch for that. But if he gets whipped tonight, I think if it were only up to Ted Cruz, I think he would do the right thing and step out. But he's got people behind him, the Jeb Bushes, the Bush family, the Neil Bushes. He's got GOP establishment people behind him. But that's fractured, too. And like I say, I'll have more details in a different video on that. So I think Ted Cruz alone would probably step out. It's the people behind him. It's the money powers behind him, the NWO powers behind him that may say, well, sorry, Ted, we don't care if your political career gets ruined or whatever. Don't worry. We'll put plenty of money in your bank. So I think that, you know, basically it's a toss-up. If it was up to Ted, he probably would. But anyway, time will tell. We're about to find out tonight.
Okay, there goes Richard Reeves, InfoWars reporter. Thanks for joining us, Richard.
Thank you very much, Paul. We'll see you guys later in some more videos, and keep it up with InfoWars.com.
Okay, there goes Richard Reeves. And, of course, the top story on Drudge right now, this is out of Zero Hedge. Ted Cruz explodes in epic anti-Trump rant. He's utterly amoral, narcissist, philandering, pathological liar. This is a quote from Ted Cruz. He continues to double down. Quote, "This man is a pathological liar. He doesn't know the difference between truth and lies." Well, Cruz just told a massive whopper out there in public while he was trying to stage this incident to impugn Trump as a liar. He said Trump told the New York Times he wasn't going to build the wall. He wasn't going to deport anyone. Trump never said that. Even the New York Times said that he never said that, because they're not even going to publish the interview. If it was that explosive, they would publish it. Again, there's no evidence that Trump ever said that. So in calling out Trump for being a liar, Ted Cruz continues to tell whopper after whopper, and it's not looking too good for him, given his poll numbers, given his tiny crowds. There's no enthusiasm behind him whatsoever. There's no momentum, and he's basically finished. But again, he's carrying the water for an establishment that wants to drag this onto the convention to try and screw Trump, to try and stab him in the front, as they've promised to do all along. So we'll continue to track it. Let's go to this Mark Dice video now. Basically, Dice went out again to the beaches of San Diego, that hotspot of intelligence and, you know, not a lot of brain cells going around, as we've documented in the past. He basically asked millennials to show them the browsing history on their phones. Of course, they don't care that the government's surveilling them. They don't care that there's a location tracker on their iPhone, which most people don't even know exists, that tells you, that records every single location down to the exact street number where you've been. They don't care about the government having that information. They do care if you ask them to show you their Google history. Let's go to this Mark Dice clip. So again, the common refrain, "What do you have to hide?" doesn't stand up when you actually say, "Well, give me your password then. Show me your browsing history." Then people get concerned about it. They're not concerned about a monolithic government having that power. They are concerned about a random person on the street having that power, which again is the complete millennial disconnect. And this is why people really don't care about intrusions to their privacy, because as long as it's, you know, a few steps away behind this monolithic government, they're just not interested. But if you ask them for their password, then they start to get nervous. Let's hit a few more news stories here in the final few minutes. "Merkel served me for tea," comedian says. A German comedian who could be prosecuted for mocking the Turkish president has accused Angela Merkel of filleting him and serving him for tea. So again, this is Jan Böhmermann, who basically wrote a poem insulting the Turkish president. And Merkel basically threw him to the dogs and said that this should go to court, because Germany has this bizarre draconian law which says that if you insult a head of state, then that's a crime. Absolutely tyrannical. We'll get back into this and other news in the final segment of the Alex Jones Show, 4th hour overdrive, InfoWars.com. Stay right there. We are back on the final segment of the Alex Jones Show, 4th hour overdrive, and I would like to encourage you to visit InfoWarsStore.com. We've got a number of great discounts off Anthroplex, Brain Force, Survival Shield, the Skeletal Defense Pack, Bone Support, and more. And of course, getting these products is vital, because it helps us build as a news organization. It helps us send reporters out to document and confront these vile social justice warrior leftists, to get them on tape, to show the world, to give an insight as to what, you know, what they stand for, what kind of activity they engage in. It's vital to help us send reporters out to cover Bilderberg every single year. The more reporters we can send out, the more hotspots we can cover, the better we can challenge mainstream media narratives. Because although their power is declining in terms of influence, they've still got a lot of money. So they're able to send reporters out to all these events and act like a real news organization, even though it is just an act. In our case, we're trying to cover as many hotspots as possible. We've been able to do that more over the past few years, but only with your support. So please continue to support us by getting the products at InfoWarsStore.com. Now, I talked earlier about the messages that I was receiving from students at the University of Massachusetts, where if a male student goes to a party and basically looks at a woman, she files sexual assault charges. Well, this is out of the College Fix. Female student straddles guy without his consent. He gets suspended for rape. This is a quote out of the article. She straddled him and started unbuttoning his shirt, according to John Doe's court filings. Later, he alleged she fondled him, which he took as a clear indication of her consent. John asked her to go further, but she declined. The two parted about 1:30 a.m. Yet 2 days later, she accused him of failing to obtain her consent, going to both the hospital and police claiming that John, quote, tried to force her to perform oral sex. So again, yet another case of one of these feminists being radicalized in the gender studies class, being radicalized by the propaganda about the college rape campus myth, which doesn't exist, and then treating any sexual contact, even though she initiated it, as sexual assault on behalf of the man. This is increasing in occurrence, it's increasing in severity, even though in every single case, the UVA rape hoax prime amongst them, turns out to be a complete fraud. Mattress girl, fraud. Fraud after fraud, and yet this narrative, you know, one in five women are raped on college campuses, continues to be proffered by not only the mainstream media, but also by people like Obama himself. Again, completely ludicrous. Over in Germany, the cultural enrichment of Europe continues. German cover-up scandal, ministry urged erasing rape from monstrous Cologne migrant attack report. Now, we know that they covered up the fact that these attacks even happened for 3 days afterwards, again, committed by a large group of predominantly Muslim migrants. Now it's emerged that one of the top police officers engaged in the investigation ordered the word rape to be removed entirely. Over in France, we've got the Minister for Urban Affairs, Patrick Kanner, saying that there are 100 neighborhoods in France that present potential similarities with what's happened in Molenbeek, which of course was the wellspring of radicalization, which produced the Brussels bombers and several of the Paris massacre plotters. So the urban area minister over there in France is basically saying we have 100 of these areas, while the media still pretends that Muslim no-go ghetto zones don't exist. Danish exhibit portraying Paris and Brussels attackers as martyrs reported to police. Basically, they had this leftist artist exhibition which said that the Brussels and Paris terrorists were heroes in their own way. That's how the left treats terrorists. That's going to wrap it up for this edition of the Alex Jones Show. InfoWars Nightly News tonight, and Alex will be back 11 to 2 tomorrow. Thanks for joining us, InfoWars.com.